2022 was an unforgettable year for Barrett-Jackson.
It was the most successful year in our history, and now we're back in Scottsdale to keep things rolling in 2023.
We've got classics.
And customs.
Broncos and Blazers.
American muscle and European exotics. Racing royalty and collections fit for a king.
Electrifying rides.
And world record holders.
And we even have a Batmobile.
It's truly an incredible lineup of collector cars.
And they're crossing the auction block all week long.
It's the Barrett-Jackson Collector Car Auction.
And it starts right now on FYI.
This is it, the event we've been waiting all year for, Barrett-Jackson in Scottsdale. It's finally arrived, and boy, what an auction it's shaping up to be. More than 1,900 cars will be crossing the block during the course of the next week, every single one of them going at no reserve. And what a collection. I mean, everything from supercars to entry level. We've even got a gremlin that's going to be crossing the block. And of course, today starts the auction itself. But the fun here at Barrett-Jackson, well, that started a couple of days ago, Saturday morning. They have what they call Family Fun Day here at Barrett-Jackson. All the families come in, but they had a special event. It's called Supercar Therapy, part of the Driven Project. The idea is to take families who are facing severe medical issues with their children and give them a day of fun. The kids get to be VIPs, very important passengers in some spectacular machinery. Supercars even getting to cross the auction block. But once again, that was Saturday. Over the last couple of days, people have had the chance to look around, but today, people start buying cars. Now, during the course of our next 4 hours, we're going to both auction cars off, see them auction, as well as preview some of the great machinery, like this one, a 1989 Ferrari F40, a very special car. When this left the factory, it was really a race car that you could use on the street. I mean, we talk about that with the modern Ford GT, but that's a Bentley limousine compared to this. They only made 1,300 of these, but every one very expensive. And of course, you always expect to see a Ferrari in red. This color, very unique. This is called Nardo Gray. And once again, when this crosses the block, well, you're gonna see seven figures easily. The question is, what will it finally end up at? And really, that's what we're all going to be questioning during the week when we see a Ferrari or a Porsche or even an entry-level car, something fun crossing the block. What is that final number? And of course, we're going to have the greatest team to guide you through all those cars. We're going to start with our own Steve Mignante.
Well, thanks, Rick. You know, I love doing Barrett-Jackson, but of the four shows, my favorite is Scottsdale. That's because the best of the best comes out to play and gets sold here. Now, this is one of the best Camaros you can imagine. It's not a super sport, no stripes, no rally wheels, but under the hood, yeah, that's the ZL1 all-aluminum 427. This is an engine that Chevrolet designed and built to go racing in Can-Am and also in super stock drag racing for the NHRA. Only 69 of these were made. This is a real one with Jerry McNish certification. It's an amazing piece, and only stuff like this comes to Scottsdale. This is the mothership, the best show of them all. Mike Joy, what have you got?
Thanks, Steve. For 1970, Plymouth's very successful Roadrunner muscle car grew a new set of tail feathers to become the Roadrunner Superbird option. This big, very strong wing end plate, shaped like an aircraft rudder for good reason, held this horizontal wing, which contributed downforce and this stability on the high-speed tracks of Daytona and Talladega, because this was designed for NASCAR racing. A lot of the street versions had vinyl tops, not so on the racetrack. Bucket seats, full console, beautiful inside as well as out and as well as underneath, because this one has been treated to a rotisserie restoration. This is a brand new car. The Superbird option also included this metal nose cone, again designed for high speed stability. Some states required a front bumper. It's this little piece of vinyl here. That's the bumper. Now, a 440 was the standard engine in the Superbird, but if you paid an extra $1,000, you could get this, the King Kong of engines, the 426 cubic inch Hemi V8. Only 77 of this car were built with the Hemi and the Torque Flight automatic. This is a non-numbers matching Hemi, but boy, it's there. And here is the data plate that describes all of the significant options on this car. So it has the Superbird option, Richard Petty, Pete Hamilton, won a lot of races in these that year. And of course, underneath, it's a Roadrunner. What more could you want? All right, let's fast forward a couple of decades to Tyler Hoover.
Well, Mike, you wouldn't think Lexus would have anything in common with a Superbird, but this 2012 LFA was also a race car for the street, and it was a slow seller at Lexus dealers, partially because of the $375,000 MSRP, but they're a big collectible now that sell well north of that. Its biggest claim to fame is under the hood. You have a bespoke V10 with 550 horsepower, individual throttle bodies, and you see these outlets right here. That's for the exhaust that vents through the hood. It's functional carbon fiber. And when you go inside, come take a look at this. The interior on this thing, it doesn't look like a 2012. It doesn't look like it's aged today. Absolutely gorgeous. Tons of carbon fiber in there. And then you go to the back and you have this active spoiler here. And my mission this week is to hear this car fire up and give it a little rev, because these things are so unique, so amazing. Just a gorgeous car. April, you're going a little newer, right?
Just a little bit newer. I am in heaven. This is a beautiful machine. 2019 Ford GT Carbon Series. This is a street legal race car. Check out this teardrop shape that goes back right into these flying buttresses. You have these air intakes feeding the intercooler and the brakes right here. Now, all that hot air exits right through that bullseye taillight. Such a cool ride. Now, it's got that mid-mounted twin turbocharged 3.5-liter EcoBoost, 7-speed dual-clutch automatic, and that lightweight package with the carbon fiber saves you about one April Rose in weight. Beautiful carbon fiber accents all around. And check out these wheels. Really cool 20-inch carbon fiber wheels with titanium lug nuts. Those red Brembo calipers peeking through. Such a cool look. And I want you to check out this back end. Come on over here. It reminds me of the movie Alien. It almost looks like an alien. This car is out of this world. Murph, what do you got?
Thank you very much, April, and hello, everyone. If you've been watching our broadcast over the years, well, the name Jeff Hayes may well be familiar to you. But even if you don't know the name, you may well know his Corvette Resto mods. Every single one of Jeff Hayes's builds are special and unique, and lot 1367 is absolutely no exception. Now this one, it is finished in a special paint that Jeff Hayes himself built. He calls it Dirty Martini, and here's the brilliance of Jeff Hayes. He matched it to this beautiful buttercream interior with that fastidious attention to detail that only Jeff Hayes can bring to these beautiful vehicles. Now, under the hood, and I should mention that the hood, well, it goes up with the touch of a button, a power hood. There's an LS3 that delivers about 540 horsepower, plenty of power to get you from A to B and have some fun along the way. I absolutely love this car. I had the opportunity to speak with Jeff Hayes before the auction, and we'll preview that story later in the week. But on Saturday, well, this 1967 beautiful Corvette Chevy goes across the block, and another chapter in the Jeff Hayes story will unfold. Rick, back to you.
Tell you what, as you walk around here, the question is not what do you like, how many cars do you like, because everything is spectacular. Every time you turn around, there's something it seems you've never seen before. And by the way, a lot of those cars you've seen and we previewed, we'll be watching those cross the block on Super Saturday. Let's talk about today. We've got 4 hours here on FYI. Tuesday, we're live at 5 p.m. until 11 p.m. on FYI. Same thing on Wednesday and Thursday. Friday, we start at 3 until 6 on the History Channel. 6 p.m. to midnight, we're live on FYI. And, of course, Super Saturday, which is going to be so spectacular. 2 o'clock in the afternoon until 6 p.m., 4 hours on FYI. And then from 6 p.m. Eastern Time until midnight, we are live on the History Channel. 1,900 cars, everyone at no reserve. Which one do you want to watch cross the block? Well, you've got days of coverage. Make yourself, you sit right down in front of your TV, because you're not going to want to miss a minute.
Walk around the Barrett-Jackson Collector Car Auction and you are inundated with numbers. There's VIN numbers and lot numbers and cubic inches and horsepower, facts and figures everywhere.
But when you take a moment to step back and look at all those numbers together, well, they paint a pretty spectacular picture. Let's start with 1,920. That's how many cars will cross the block this week, every single one at no reserve. How many Fords? Well, there's 351. Ah, but Chevy leads the way. 780 bow ties here at Barrett-Jackson. 49 of those are Blazers. 58 Broncos here. You want exotics? There's 11 Lamborghinis, 12 Ferraris, 23 Bentleys. Ah, but leading the way in the European exotics? It's Porsche. 58 of these things. There's 19 Cudas, 17 GTOs, 126 Camaros. Ah, but the number one model here at Barrett-Jackson is probably not a surprise. It's Corvette. 187 of the cross-flag cars. There are 770 cars that are classified as custom, more than a third of the entire docket. So do the math. It all adds up to a great week.
Thank goodness my son has a finance degree, because we are swimming in numbers here at Barrett-Jackson. It is only Monday, and yes, this cavernous arena is full of people, and they have come to see these beautiful cars in the salon, in that half-mile tent behind them, and in half a dozen tents outside here at Westworld. It is just an unbelievable overload of car love that's going on right here. Right in the midst of it stands Tyler Hoover.
Yes, I'm one of the many people in the salon drooling over the cars, and I think I found the fastest one here, lot 1391, a Ferrari SF90. Not only is it a beautiful design, but it's Ferrari's most efficient aerodynamic car ever. Also, it is a hybrid, their second-gen hybrid technology. The front wheels have two electric motors, but then you go in the back and you have a beautiful Ferrari V8 under here. Combined horsepower, just shy of 1,000 to the quarter mile, under 10 seconds. But look how low that intake is on the V8. Very low center of gravity here. You can also see the two turbos sticking out on either side of the oil canister. But this car, I mean, just gorgeous and absolutely the latest that Ferrari offers. Love it.
Nothing not to love right there, Tyler. Thank you very much. We appreciate that. One of the many spectacular supercars we'll watch across the block. And check out the bidding area here in the auction arena. Got to remember, this is only Monday, and this room is packed. Record number of bidders. And remember, you can bid over the telephone. You can bid over the internet. You don't have to be here in the room. But for so many people, if you're going to go to an auction, this is the auction they want to go to. Up in the block right now, let's go to our first car. In this case, it's a 1996 Buick Roadmaster Custom.
Well, the Roadmaster is similar to a Chevy Caprice or Impala at this point in time, one of the last body-on-frame, full-sized American, well, General Motors passenger cars. But again, the heart of a Corvette, the LT1, making 260 horsepower.
We called these Road Blasters back in the day. They were huge, and they're very luxurious, and a lot of room both inside and out. Plenty of rear seat legroom in these full-size cars. Those aluminum alloy wheels are factory, as are all the moldings. It is Barrett-Jackson practice to label every car a custom if it varies at all from original production spec. But Steve, I can't see what they've customized here. This one looks very stock to me.
Indeed it is. One thing I love about these cars, these have true dual exhaust, which is something that, of course, in the 50s and 60s was a signature of a performance V8 under the hood. And of course, these have a twin catalytic converter. But again, dual exhaust from the factory. And again, the last gasp right here for full-size GM passenger car, the Buick Roadmaster.
$64,000 actual miles on this one, and a clean Carfax report, so no hits, no dings, no errors. Nice way to float down the road.
Yeah, the Roadmaster nameplate arrived in the early 1950s as Buick's largest, most luxurious offering. Of course, this one does not have the vestigial venter ports on the front fenders, which were part of the Buick picture from 49 well into the 1980s. But again, this is largely a Chevy Impala SS under the skin, four-wheel disc brakes, but again, body-on-frame, classic American full-size construction. Of course, Buick would go to front-wheel drive shortly after these were discontinued. So if you want a big American car, here's one of your last chances.
Scottsdale, the big 5.7 liter.
And it's important to point out that, you know, the auction is building over the course of the week. Today's entry level day. You know, a lot of fun stuff like this that'll come across. And someone says, can I buy a car for less than $10,000 at Barrett-Jackson? Absolutely, during the first hour on the first day, because these are the cars that start things off. But as the auction builds each day, the quality of the car and, most importantly, the prices of the cars will continue to go up.
Something you wouldn't tolerate today are panel gaps like this. But again, clean Carfax car has never been hit. These quarter-inch gaps were typical of what rolled out of the factory at that time.
One cool thing is this car had a big brother, the Roadmaster Estate, which actually was a full-size wagon. And yes, they revisited the glass windows in the top of that, which were first seen on the old Vista Cruiser and, of course, Buick Sport wagon of the 60s. So again, full-size American stuff. Of course, Ford's Crown Victoria continued in production for many years after GM gave up on the body-on-frame. But again, these are a thing of the past at this point. Everything now is either front or all-wheel drive.
$7,900, Kevin Teeth. Well, there it is, the very first car sold at Barrett-Jackson in Scottsdale for 2023, a 1996 Buick Roadmaster Custom. Away it goes at $7,900. We're going to check in with Christian Murphy, who's got a special guest standing by.
Thank you very much, Rick. A very, very special guest, of course, Craig Jackson, chairman and CEO of Barrett-Jackson. We're up and running Scottsdale 23. Before we dive into that, I want to talk about 2022, one of your most successful years on record. What were some of the drivers of that success, and what was happening in the collector car hobby that drove so many great results?
Well, I think it's the same thing you're seeing at the start of 23. You have so much liquidity out there. You have so much pent-up demand. There's a lot of factors in different types of cars. The availability of cars, the instant gratification of coming to an auction. Then you get into, you've got high interest rates, inflation, and collector cars have long over the trend. We don't advise buying them as an investment. If you buy what you love, it tends to work out.
Well, we're into a new year, and new you look pretty well. Barrett-Jackson, very much a barometer of the market, especially at this time of year as we go into 2023. What are some of the trends that you see continuing on into this year, or some emerging trends that we may see blossom?
Well, I think you're going to continue to see, as you look at the docket, supercars are still very, very popular, especially the GTs are now out of production. You have a lot of hypercars that are in here that are now out of production. As we head towards more full electric cars, we are standing next to a modern hybrid here. You're going to see the last of the super petroleum cars going up in value across all the manufacturers. And you're starting to see the SUVs across all types really coming into their own.
Well, I'm glad you raised that. One of the things that we and our team have talking about is the Broncos that are crossing the block, the trucks. Is that more a slight shift to more of a lifestyle collector car where people are using it in different ways?
It is. And, you know, we talk about resto mods, and trucks are now resto modded. Resto mods started with Mustangs, and, you know, you do Camaros or you do Tri-5 Chevys. We have a pair of English resto mods here that Simon Cowell bought, sent to England, had them upgraded and brought back. You can resto mod anything, but a resto modded Jeep or a K5 Blazer, it takes you back to when you were a child, but now you can put all the modern conveniences that you're used to nowadays and still have that look and feel. And that is what a resto mod truly is.
Yeah, wonderful. Well, we're going to check in with you, if it's okay, during the week, get your insights and see what's happening from the block to the floor. Thank you very much, and we'll see you later in the day.
Thank you.
Back to you, Rick.
Thanks a lot, Murph. We appreciate that. Yeah, it's interesting picking his brain about all the trends that are coming up. And check this out, a 1993 Pontiac Firebird Formula that we'll see before too long. V8 engine, 5.7 liter, 5-speed manual transmission.
The all-new line of Barrett-Jackson merchandise and apparel is now available. From road rallies to the office, there are many stylish options for the car lover. Available year-round or online at shopbarrettjackson.com.
Back here on day one of the Barrett-Jackson Collector Car Auction. Off to the right, you see that? Don't see those very often here. A 1984 AMC Eagle wagon. And that just hammered sold at $10,000. Remember what we said, Monday is entry-level day. It's a great day to pick up some good deals or something unusual. Once again, you don't see those very often. So it's fun to watch that go across the auction block. A wide variety of things will be crossing there today. No shortage of pickup trucks. We got more than 300 of them crossing the block over the course of this Barrett-Jackson auction in Scottsdale. This one's a 1995 Ford Ranger Custom.
These are interesting. This has what Ford called the twin traction beam front axle. That's actually an articulated beam axle riding on coils, a descendant of Ford's twin I-beam suspension of the mid-60s. But again, this one's been pretty modified. Got a 4-liter V6 under the hood. I like the effect here. Less can be more.
Very cool Baja-looking truck, and it looks like it's just back from a trip to the dunes. A little nick here and there. Fiberglass fenders flared out. This was born a Ranger Splash, which in itself was a fairly rare version of this truck. And you see a lot of the added gusseting. They didn't even bother to paint this. They just added the gusset here to try to strengthen up this bed. So this one's ready to go off-road. Obviously, somebody's had a lot of fun with it. 4-liter, as Steve said, with a 5-speed manual. So cool little truck.
Yeah, this is sort of built in the pre-runner style, wherein before you run the actual race off-road, you might pre-run it to see the course in something like this. More suspension travel. A rear axle on this one, by the way, is a Ford 8.8-inch, and that refers to the diameter of the ring gear. Same rear axle basically used in the 5-liter Mustang. Very tough piece, although this is equipped with drum brakes at the back. No discs on the back of this one, but that's all good. But I like these fiberglass bed sides here with their built-in wide body effect. Very cool.
You know, and the concept of the smaller pickup truck went away after the Ranger, and of course everybody still loved them, so they had to bring it back with the new modern Maverick, the Ford Maverick that's out now. I tell you what, at this price, why not? I mean, you can have fun. We live here in Arizona. You can go out and enjoy the desert. You know, it's a little rough around the edges, but that's exactly what you want.
And it's a very honest build, Rick. There is no lipstick on this one.
There you go. $4,000, the final price on the 1995 Ford Ranger Pickup Custom. All kinds of fun stuff on that Baja truck. We're going to check in with April Rose.
This is so cool. This is a charity car going across on Saturday. VIN number one, 2024 Hummer EV, fully electric. Now, it's unbelievable to think this big box right here is all electric. All these electric cars you see are very aerodynamic and smooth. Not this. 0 to 60 in about 3.5 seconds, 830 horsepower. Now, you'll see a lot of tributes to the moon landing, which right here I want to show you. This is where Apollo 11 landed, and they have a topography map in the speaker. Neil Armstrong's boot print right there. Very cool. On the inside also, you're going to see a lot of bronze accents, which Apollo 11 had as well. And I love this infinity roof with removable panels you store in the front trunk. Now, the charity it's tied with is called Tread Lightly, which promotes keeping our earth clean, and 100% of the Hummer price goes directly to it. Rick?
I love all the little Easter eggs they've got in there about the Apollo mission. It's really great to look at all that kind of stuff. And by the way, that's just one of five charity cars that are going to sell this week. And when it's over, we expect the full charity money raised over the entire history of Barrett-Jackson during this auction to surpass $150 million. Once again, they take a time to sell these cars with every penny going to a great cause. So $150 million, we're going to surpass that sometime this week.
It'll be a very special moment.
Right now, a 1989 GMC Jimmy S15 up on the block.
Well, I had this truck's close cousin, the Chevy S10 Blazer, with the same 4.3 V6 automatic. And younger folks won't recognize that on the floor. That is not the shifter. Shifter's up on the column. That is to put this car into four-wheel drive because it's not AWD or all-wheel drive, and so you have to shift it. How you like those two-tone cloth and vinyl seats? Very nice, luxurious sport truck.
Yeah, the best part of this one is up on the front underneath the driver's side headlight, and that is where the vaunted 4.3-liter emblem appears. Now, earlier version of this would have had a 2.8-liter 60-degree V6, very much underpowered, but that 4.3 is basically a V8 minus two cylinders, so finally, he's got good power. That 4.3 is a very potent little engine.
Yeah, I've had one of each, Steve, and a huge difference with the 4.3, which was basically a small block Chevy V8 with the two rear cylinders cut off. That's how they made the 4.3 V6. Was a great engine for these small sport utes.
Yeah, Mike, to your point, 4.3 liters is 262 cubic inches, which is about the same displacement as the Chevy small block was in 55 when it came out as a 265. So it's a big V6 right there.
$6,800 for a 1989 GMC Jimmy S15. Interestingly enough, just barely over 80,000 miles in the 33 years that it's been around. We have a lot of great collections that we have here at Barrett-Jackson. We're going to be crossing the block, and we're going to check in with company CEO Craig Jackson about the Northside collection.
We are here at Northside Customs, and we have an amazing collection. One of the headline cars of the collection, this beautiful ZL1. This is number 61 out of the 69. And the last 18 cars had options. This one has a tach and a radio. Beautiful car. What else do we have, Mike?
Craig, we got some great Mustangs. I'm a big Mustang enthusiast, as you know. We got a 1969. Boss 429 finished in Wimbledon white. We got a very late production 1970 Boss 429 finished in Calypso Coral. What an amazing group of cars.
When we walked into the collection, this car really caught my eye. I don't know why, but I just like a plum crazy with a white interior Hemi Cuda. Now, this is where really muscle cars hit their peak, 70, 71. And then they brought out these mean boys, the next generation. And the Demon was something else when these first came out. Hard to get, still very hard to get. 840 horsepower stock.
Two more great pieces from the Northside Customs collection. First is a 1963 Chevrolet Corvette split window. This one's equipped with a 327. 340 horsepower V8, which is a solid lifter camshaft with a single four-barrel carburetor. And then this, one of my favorite cars, the 1987 Buick Grand National GNX. They built 547 of these cars in 1987. It was the fastest American production car built that year. This car is number 463 of the 547. And what's really incredible, it has only 488 miles from new. So it's like going back in a time machine and picking one up off the dealer lot.
Here we have a couple of real cool trucks. So this 56 Divco milk truck has been completely customized. Sitting a custom chassis, four-wheel disc brakes on it. When you really start looking around, it's got LS power. It has a 56 Chevy dash inside of it, tilt column. Everything in this is completely custom. Pretty cool piece. What do you have there, Mike?
Craig, this is a 1952 Ford, completely custom top to bottom. It's on an air ride suspension. It has 24-inch billet wheels. As you can see, it's all the way down on the ground. It's got a 6-liter Ford Power Stroke diesel engine in it, fully customized interior all the way. I can say I've never seen anything like this.
Great collection we've seen today, all coming to you at no reserve.
Gotta love those milk trucks, and you gotta love this, one of the cars from the Northside Collection. It's lot 1354.1, a 1969 Boss 9. 429 cubic inches, Wimbledon white, about as desirable a Mustang as you can possibly ask for. We're gonna take a quick break, but we'll come back in just a moment to Scottsdale. Welcome back to Westworld in Scottsdale, the Barrett-Jackson Collector Car Auction. Yeah, the room is packed, and we haven't even gotten to Super Saturday yet. Can only imagine what it's going to be like with all the people that are coming for all the spectacular machinery. But what a great week. I mean, every day there's something interesting that'll be crossing the box. It just boils down to what appeals to you, whether it's a car, a truck, or a motorcycle. In this case, a 2001 Kawasaki Vulcan.
The Vulcan was Kawasaki's attempt to take market share from Harley-Davidson. Doesn't this look like a road-going Harley right down to the V-twin engine, which displaces 805 cubic centimeters? These did not have the vibration of the Harleys due to the offset crankshaft that were used in what were called metric cruisers. Yamaha, Honda, Kawasaki all offered them, and this one is completely stock and has been preserved since it was born in 2001. It has just 2,500 actual miles. So a beautiful, faithfully maintained metric cruiser right here.
I like Kawasaki's choice of wheels, although by this point in time, forged aluminum spoked wheels would be the rule. They went with retro wire wheels as found on a classic Harley V-twin of the day.
Beautiful candy wine red metallic with black gold edge stripes. That is all factory, as is all of that chrome, the dual pipes coming out the right side. Yep, if you want to cruise like you've got a V-twin Harley, but you don't want a bit of that vibration and you want something, well, that you can get serviced and parts at your local import motorcycle shop, maybe this is the one for you.
Kawi started using the Vulcan name back in the 80s, and of course it's continued on. They've got a number of different series for them. This is the 800 series. Just over 50 horsepower. Good, solid enough to get you where you're going. Pleasant, and more importantly, a nice, pleasant ride.
Disc brake up front, drum in the back, and of course the drum is integrated into the rear hub, but the disc brake is more effective really at stopping than would be a drum, so a bit of old, a bit of new on this one.
Five-speed transmission, great low feel to it. $3,200 for a 2001 Kawasaki Vulcan. Let's check in with Tyler Hoover.
I'm with lot 48, a 2004 Chevy 1500 custom pickup truck, and we'll take a look at the engine with our blueprint engine cam. Come take a look here. It is a 4.8 liter V8 under the hood, a Vortec. This was the truck version of the LS. Now, when I was a Chevy salesman back when these were new, I learned them very well. You have the 4.8 liter V8, the 5.3 V8, and the 6 liter. Vortec just means they make a vortex inside of the engine with the air fuel mixture for maximum efficiency. This one is very original, is a clean blank slate that you could build up to something really cool.
Love it. It'll be up on the block before too long. Thanks a lot, Tyler. And meanwhile, up on the block right now, our first British vehicle, a 1991 Jaguar XJ6. This one's a sovereign edition.
Well, this body style went many, many years. I believe 68, first year for this essential styling. But again, this is European headlights on this one. These are glass, not plastic, guaranteed to never fade or require any kind of buffing or refreshing. But again, just a great example. This one's a six-cylinder, an inline six, not a 12.
Yeah, 4 liter straight six. They have the hood latched on that side, sorry. Now, we rely heavily on the vehicle history reports, as do the bidders, and the Carfax shows this was involved in an accident with another vehicle in 1997. But what a luxurious machine, and especially rear seat legroom, probably rivaled only by the Mercedes S-Class.
you know, your Jaguar XJs, you realize some of them had twin tanks and fillers. By this point in time, they were consolidated to this side. But earlier examples would have a filler on each side. Very convenient, pulling up to a gas pump. No need to predict which side the tank is on. But again, they went to a single fill on this generation.
Sovereign Edition, just a little more luxury than the base XJ6 that was offered. And like you said, this was a body style that in this form had been around for a long time. And you take it even further back and you've got a much more rounded version of it as well.
The wheels on this one, Mike might have pointed out, not sure, but I don't think those are factory. They're replacements, but they're aluminum. They look okay. Similar to the five spokes this would have had from the factory, but not the same.
And of course, for all our British friends, there's another version of this sharing essentially the same body style, which is the Daimler's, which, you know, you get the 66, you get a number of vehicles offered over there, very similar except for the grill.
These are fairly advanced cars, four-wheel disc brakes, independent rear suspension. In fact, the rear suspension on this is similar to the original Jaguar E-Type, sort of a cage with inboard disc brakes for reduced wheel weight.
$4,000 for a 1991 Jaguar XJ6 Sovereign Edition. Away it goes. That could be a fun thing to walk away from Barrett-Jackson with. And we've talked a lot about the great cars that are going to be crossing the block over the course of the next week. And Craig Jackson standing right by right now with a very interesting Porsche.
We have a 2005 Porsche Carrera GT. It's one of the stars of the show. This Carrera GT was built in February 2005, priced at $452,989 new, one of 644 Carrera examples sold new in the United States. It is powered by a 5.7 liter V10 rated at 603 horsepower, mated to a 6-speed manual transmission. The cars had limited use with approximately 3,300 miles from new.
This thing really wants to rev. 8,200 red line. It gets there quick.
No shortage of spectacular machinery that will be crossing the block. And literally every day there's something interesting to see. Got a lot of fun stuff that's going to be crossing the block today. And doesn't matter whether you like European, exotic, supercars, it's all going to be crossing the Barrett-Jackson block this week with the 1,900 cars. Up there, a 1997 Jaguar XJ Vandenplas.
Well, Vandenplas is the name of a British coachmaker, which was adapted and adopted for the long wheelbase, extra length car we see here. The rear door is about 6 inches longer for entry and egress, and lots of more legroom in the back.
In earlier days, Vandenplas was a coach builder. They would buy an engine and chassis from one of the British manufacturers, and the name morphed into what you see here with an ultra luxurious presentation. Note the little wood, the beautiful burled wood trays that fold down there, just all part of that very luxurious package.
$4,000 for that 1997 Jaguar. We're going to stay in the Jaguar world, rolling up right behind it, a little bit newer, 2002. This one's interesting, though. This one is a Jaguar XJ Sport.
Well, the first of these we saw had the European-style headlamps. That's because in Europe, they approved very aerodynamic headlamp treatments well before they were legal in America. In America, when this car came out, you could either have a single 7-inch round headlamp or you could have dual 5 3/4 round headlamps, and that was it. We trailed the European and Asian makes, oh, by quite a number of years before aerodynamic looking headlights became legal in the US and the stylists got involved.
One detail that's kind of important on this one, it's a sport with the monochrome body kit, but more importantly, right there, V8, 4-liter overhead cam V8 power. No six-cylinder on this one. This is basically like an Impala SS, if you will, of the Jaguar XJ family. Bit of a subdued muscle sedan.
Now note these five-spoke wheels. This is what Steve spoke of earlier. This is the stock Jaguar alloy wheel, made mostly of aluminum, very lightweight. Those three-piece wheels we saw in the car earlier would not have been stock.
And if you want, of course, want to take the XJ range to its most extreme, do you remember the Jaguar XJ220? Tom Walkinshaw racing them. They actually had a series here in the United States, the Legend Series, with a bunch of, shall we say, veteran race car drivers thrashing them around, doing some pretty serious fun with them. But that was the ultimate extension of the XJ Series.
They were called the Fastmasters, those vintage drivers, and Brian Redman had a much more colorful name from them that rhymed with what I just said, and I won't repeat it here.
I do remember that, once again, a lot of great veteran drivers having a an awful lot amount of fun driving those Fastmaster cars, and the cars did not survive most of that. We're going to take a break, but we are going to come back to Scottsdale in just a moment.
Barrett-Jackson, the world's greatest collector car auctions, returns to Palm Beach, April 13th through the 15th. Be a part of the action at the South Florida Fairgrounds and consign today. Our pre-qualified bidders want your collector car. Visit Barrett-Jackson.com to get started.
Back here in Scottsdale, those are all the folks out in the bidding area. They're waiting to raise their hand, and if they like Firebirds, how about this one, a 1993 Pontiac Firebird Formula. This is the one we previewed just a little while ago for you.
A lot of people like the Formula because the styling was not as out there and flashy as the Trans Am. The performance was, though, 5.7-liter V8, 5-speed manual transmission, and this one has been well-kept.
Yeah, the thing I like about this, it's an Arizona car, Arizona title, been here all its life, nice and dry, no rust underneath. And keep in mind, the Formula, no V6 possible, always the 5.7. Of course, by 1993, that's the LT1 with 275 horsepower, not the LS1, which had 300. But again, a very low-key, high-performance Firebird right here. Very clean example.
So we'll have to see if the 88,000 miles on the clock holds this one back or not. But a really nice, stealthy-looking, what was very high-performance car for 1993.
When you think about it, 30 years, 88,000 miles, that's not too shabby when you get right down to it. You know, this was the beginning of the end for both Pontiac and the Firebird. Big change from 1992 to 1993, big styling change, and of course, this was the last, essentially, generation of the Firebird to be made.
That's a good point. This is the first year right here for the Gen 4 F-body, or Firebird, if you will, with sort of the Corvette Stingray 3 show car styling traits. But again, plastic body panels, doors, fenders, plastic, quarter panels are steel, but lightweight and pretty strong stuff.
One thing you saw there that kind of turned off buyers was acres of molded plastic inside. Just part of the way things were in that styling cycle.
$7,200 for that 1993 Pontiac Firebird Formula. And with that, we're going to check in with April Rose.
I'm with the Bill Mundy Collection. Beautiful 1963 Corvette. Oh, my favorite year. Now, these are first-generation Corvettes, but I got to tell you, my absolute favorite, almost unbelievable, first year 1953 Corvette. Now, they only made 300 of them, and about 225 exist today. And get this, they were all painted polo white. Now, there's a reason, because it's the first time Chevy worked with a full fiberglass body. And since fiberglass is kind of new to work with for them, white hides all the imperfections, unlike darker colors. Now, what's even better, this is a so-called barn find, okay? It had a full restoration to all the correct specs, and even the paint is a correct lacquer. Now, it's got that blue flame inline six-cylinder and Chevy's two-speed Powerglide automatic transmission. I mean, this belongs in a museum. There should be red rope all around it. This is a piece of true American history, and it's all part of the Bill Mundy Collection. DeBrule?
Thanks a lot. Look forward to that. Very cool. Great collection of Corvettes. No shortage of Corvettes, but more than 180 of them in total that will be crossing the block. Another Jaguar right now. This one's a little bit smaller, though, a 2007 Jaguar X-Type.
Our British friends would call this an estate. We call them a station wagon here. Of course, the BMW 5 Series would be this car's natural competitor, as the station wagon market was pretty much gone by 2007. But again, a last gasp, V6 all-wheel drive. Nice example.
Well, long roofs have become really big at Barrett-Jackson. Now we're talking mostly classic station wagons. But I love these compacts, and the Europeans did it right. Jaguar, BMW, Mercedes, and Audi all produced wagons of this kind of variant, and all in all-wheel drive as well as two-wheel drive. This is a stunner, and I think only the 78,000 miles on the odometer might kind of hold this one back.
You know, I was just in the Netherlands a few months ago going around Europe, and a ton of great-looking station wagons based off of European sedans that we don't get over here in the United States.
Well, here we went for crossovers so that drivers could be higher up and at the same level of, say, minivans and look at traffic. But in Europe, yeah, station wagons still reign.
If you're a Mopar enthusiast, you'll know that the Dodge Magnum was the American wagon. Well, in Europe and Saudi Arabia, there's a Chrysler 300 station wagon available over there with diesel power and Hemi power. Nothing we got here, but it's funny, all the cars that exist in other parts of the country or world that are like cousins, but you can't get them here. But again, these are popular little cars in New England, all-wheel drive, go through snow, summer, you name it.
Well, this 2007 Jaguar X-Type goes away to a new owner. And the Summit Racing sold sticker goes on, and away it goes for $7,000. Plenty of Cadillacs will be crossing the block as well, and right now we got a 2000 Eldorado.
Well, the Eldorado debuted in 1967 as Cadillac's two-door, four-seat, or two-plus-two, personal luxury car. Here we are some 30 years later, and this one now has a 4.6-liter V8. Backed up, as they all were, with automatic transmissions. Now, this one has not been well used, only 37,000 actual miles, and very luxurious inside.
Yeah, it's hides in plain sight, but these are front-wheel drive, as was the original 1967 Eldorado. Of course, before that, Eldorado was a full-size rear-wheel drive car, but from 67 onward, Eldo means front-wheel drive.
Very luxurious for two, a little cramped for four. So we'll call this a 2+2. They are all automatics, of course, all with great sound systems. Just enough bespoke burled wood or imitation thereof to give it just the right look and feel.
This does have the Cadillac North Star dual overhead cam engine, 275 horsepower, a very potent engine, and it'll boil these front tires at the touch of the pedal.
It's interesting if you compare the overall length of one of these to some of those mid-60s Eldorados. Once again, they were just coupes. They only had two doors, but they were massive, 228 inches long. This one's significantly shorter than that.
Yes, Rick, this was the Executive Express as the millennium turned.
This one does have a New York State inspection sticker here on the windshield. I'm looking for signs of respray or, I'd say, rust repair, but this one looks like it's been kept in a very dry environment, which is a nice bonus. It's crisp. And on the right rear corner, we see et cetera, no, European Touring Coupe. Is what ETC stands for, not et cetera, but you make about what you want.
And just a couple years later, the Eldorado was gone. The name has yet to be revived by Cadillac. As a result, this is towards the end of that line. And that one just sold. We're going to check in with Christian Murphy.
Thanks very much, Rick. You know, one of the things that I do love about Barrett-Jackson is you get to go up close and personal with automotive history, like Lot 1396, 1966 Shelby Group 2 Mustang. Now, sadly, this one doesn't have such a happy ending. This vehicle, of course, was built for Shelby American race car driver Ken Miles. This is a pure racing thoroughbred. Now, this one was built to 1965 R model spec to compete in the SCCA and the Trans Am A and A sedan classes, and it has actually competed in over 30 races. And it is powered by an era correct Shelby American Racing 289 Hypo V8 attached to a four-speed auto transmission. It is fully documented in the Shelby registry, I should say, and it comes with complete restoration and photos. This one comes from the MS Classic Cars collection, and I think this is one to watch this week. Rick?
Yeah, in fact, that was the year that Ford won the Trans Am, so a lot of fun history associated with Ford in 1966. We're going to take a quick break. We'll come right back to Barrett-Jackson. Welcome back to the Barrett-Jackson Collector Car Auction out on the McGuire staging lanes. Oh, there is so much to see and enjoy. You know, it's a little bit of a chilly day here. Well, at least I think chilly for Arizona. Not as much sunshine as we're accustomed to, but I'm sure we'll get more sunshine a little bit later in the week. Temperatures will go up. And once again, in the McGuire staging lanes, all those cars, your last chance to look at them before they come up on the block.
Just don't try to tell me it's a dry cold, Rick.
Not exactly. And I feel sorry when I say it's chilly here. And, you know, you think about what it's chilly like in Minnesota or North Dakota. It's a little warmer than that. Up on the block, good money for a 2008 Volkswagen Beetle.
So for $15,000.
It's got a convertible top, a fun color. This modern generation Volkswagen Beetle bringing good money, $15,000. And that means right now it's going to be the number one sale of the day. All right. Here at Barrett-Jackson, we see all kinds of different things crossing the block. We've seen more than our fair share of tractors because there's a great following for that hobby. But this is really interesting. This is a replica custom. It's a quarter-scale John Deere tractor.
And it is said to be fully functional. Note the front tires are all cambered inward to help its stability going in a straight line down those rows in the field. Looking at the pedals and the controls, they look a lot like the 1940 Model H that my dad restored. So the Barrett-Jackson driver will climb aboard once there's room here, and he'll be ready to go. This is not only turnkey operational, but it's ready to go to work on the farm. Love this.
This one does have a two-cylinder diesel, but the pistons are arranged vertically, whereas they were horizontal on the original John Deere. But still, gotta love those dual pipes coming out the front, kind of a hot rod.
You'll see the flywheel here. Now, on the full size, not this one, that inside of that flywheel will be serrated because these did not have electric start. You had to spin the flywheel to get them to crank over. And the engine is described as a Johnny Popper, which would take more time to explain than I have. But if you go to any farm or agricultural show, you'll see them on tractors and on stationary engines that you'd find around the farm. Little lunchbox slash toolbox on the rear, power takeoff in the back, pintle hook to toe. Very cool.
In fact, if you want to get a sense of what the full-sized twin tractor looks like, there she blows on the left-hand side, the big one and the little one, the baby is on the right.
Well, I'll tell you what, this one's getting a lot of love. Remember, this is our very first day. We're only in our first hour or so, but we're at $20,000 for this replica custom John Deere tractor. This is the number one sale of the auction so far.
Well, let me go back to my dad's Model 40. In unrestored condition, it's worth about one-fifth of this.
And there's no question that John Deere collecting world is very strong, whether it's the John Deere fun stuff or whether it's the actual vehicles themselves, the tractors. And this one, done so well as a reproduction, has gotten everybody's attention here in the room.
And the tires on this are supplied by a company called Carlisle in Pennsylvania. And these are not that hard to find, which is good news. They're very specialized tires, but that's Carlisle's job. They sell special tires like these, brand new.
Well, congratulations to that gentleman right there and that family. $20,000 for a very cool John Deere replica tractor, one scale. All right. Plenty of great cars out there, but I got to tell you, Craig Jackson has found a Mercedes that is worthy of a special look.
On today's First Look, we have a 1939 Mercedes-Benz 540K Cab A conversion, lot number 1379. This vehicle started life as a Cab B body configuration. The chassis, driveline, and supercharger are all original to the car. It is powered by a 5.4-liter straight-eight with a four-speed manual transmission. A true classic, this car really reminds me of our first days at Barrett-Jackson. These are the cars I grew up restoring and Tom Barrett selling. You want to get a true classic? These cars are unbelievable. This is an opportunity.
Yeah, and that Mercedes, very special. Be selling on Saturday, part of our Super Saturday coverage. One of the first cars when you come into the auction that you see. Another one of the great cars that we'll see crossing the block later this week, bringing big money. Tyler Hoover's next to it right now.
Well, we saw a tractor sell earlier, and it's so hard to believe that Lamborghini started life as a tractor company and still sell tractors, especially when you look at this, lot 1047, a 2019 Lamborghini Aventador SVJ. Now, this is the ultimate Lamborghini Aventador, which is no longer being made. Sort of the end of Lamborghini as we know it. You see SVJ here on the back. SV means super veloce, and J means Jota, for Appendix J, basically a rare race car that dates back all the way to the original V12 Lamborghini mid-engine car, the Miura. This one, same, a naturally aspirated V12 under the hood, 770 horsepower, 215 plus mile per hour top speed. I don't need to open the bonnet because you can see it through the gills. Just an amazing car.
All right, thanks a lot, Tyler. Very cool, that Aventador. Look forward to seeing that Lamborghini up here on the block. Coming up, how about a 2002 Camaro, but this one's great. It's a Z28, 5.7 liter V8, 6-speed manual transmission. Be up on the block very soon.
The all-new line of Barrett-Jackson merchandise and apparel is now available. From road rallies to the office, there are many stylish options for the car lover. Available year-round or online at shopbarrettjackson.com.
It's a beautiful state, and this week it's home to a lot of beautiful cars. Right here in Arizona, the Barrett-Jackson Collector Car Auction. 1997 Chevy Silverado 2500. This one, interesting, it's got a 454 under the hood.
A three-quarter tonner with Chevrolet's independent four-wheel drive front suspension, no leaf springs and beam axle. A better ride. Extended cab on this one, big block power.
Has a fiberglass cap over the pickup bed. It has some rather heavy-looking chrome wheels, which are aftermarket. Factory trailer hitch. Has a dual exhaust. Ready to go back to work. Now, these 454 trucks, they had suffered in value over, say, the last, 6 or 8 years. But with the current price of diesel fuel, these are enjoying a resurgence because they can be bought fairly inexpensively and run on gas, which in almost every state is much less expensive today than diesel.
The GMT 400 styling cycle, which arrived for 1988-87. And here it is, and after a decade, still looking pretty advanced and fresh. Rounded faces for aerodynamic efficiency, lighter weight.
Now, this 454, by this time, was emission strangled to only about 220 horsepower or so, but it had prodigious torque. Great engine for towing.
So for $14,000, Chisholm.
There goes $14,000 for all that torque and that 454 cubic inches. And as he signs the paperwork, we're going to check in with Christian Murphy, standing by with a very special guest.
Thank you very much, Rick. A very special guest indeed, President Barrett-Jackson. Steve Davis, a good mate of mine. Steve, I know you're a man that loves the numbers. Let's talk about some numbers. 1,920 cars crossing the block this week at no reserve. One of the biggest dockets?
Absolutely, Murph. And the number would have been larger, except literally, not figuratively, but literally we've run out of real estate. We've parked cars anywhere and everywhere we could find. The docket, not only is it huge in numbers, but the volume speaks also to the diversity. Absolutely one of the most amazing dockets I've ever put together with this incredible team. Barrett-Jackson experience has taken it to a whole nother level this year.
It is unbelievable. And let's talk more about some numbers. 303 trucks, 187 Corvettes, 126 Camaros, and 58 Broncos. Absolutely. Broncos are here in force.
Absolutely. Broncos, one of the hottest segments. We started the consignment process as we always do, and we always talk about the personality of event. And we say, we really don't know what it is, but it's going to evolve. You start to see a pattern to emerge. And this year, we were fortunate enough to attract not only the diversity with the exotic, the classics, the 540Ks, and Ferraris, Lamborghinis, SF90s, LFAs, but these Broncos, we kept seeing incredible Bronco after incredible Bronco. And then here comes an incredible Blazer. And then we have a Jimmy. Then we have a C10 pickup. But the Bronco thing has taken a hold. The whole universe is looking for a killer Bronco, and we have some of the most incredible. If you put together the most incredible group of four-wheelers, Broncos leading the pack as far as numbers go, and had a show around the world, you would be in awe of what that promoter was able to put together. We've put it together. Not only are they here, not only are they for show, but they're all going to sell for whatever the last hand is standing. Last man standing, last hand in the air. An incredible opportunity to see some of the most finest, incredible Broncos ever assembled.
Unbelievable. You talk about the docket and you talk about a bell curve a lot. Now, today is a great day to get into the collector car hobby, but as we ramp up the week, give me a sense of some of those big ticket items, the headliners that we'll wait till Friday, which is becoming, you know, close to a Super Saturday, and then Saturday.
Absolutely. Monday, as you said, Murph, it's kind of the day that we want to call it entry level, in the sense that people want to come, they want to experience Barrett-Jackson. We want to make sure we have something for everybody. And we walked out on the block as we started the event. The place is packed. Everybody's excited. So the person buying lot number one is going to get the same excitement as a primetime Saturday. But as it relates to the diversity of the docket, and also to your point, we have everything from a 540K. We have a Group 2 Mustang 66 Shelby coupe that absolutely has incredible history. We have some of the most exotics on the planet. We have some of the most amazing Corvettes, resto mods. Again, when you think about it and you wish you could see it, it's absolutely here. But come Saturday primetime, and actually we're going to start that Saturday primetime feeling on Thursday. It's going to start early, it's going to ramp up quick, and that bell curve is going to look more like you hit the plateau and you kind of ride that peak into the sunset, but it's going to be amazing, but well, incredible cars.
The strength and diversity of the docket is a real credit to you and the team. We can't thank you enough. We are really pumped up for a great week, and take it back up now to Rick DeBrew.
Thanks a lot, Steve. Thanks a lot, Murph. We just saw a Cadillac Eldorado Biarritz sell for $21,500. Right now, up the block, we got a 1979 Ford F-250 pickup truck.
A one-owner truck with just 59,000 original miles out of Oregon and given a camper treatment. So quite a nice survivor here, Steve.
Yeah, I got to say, growing up, I remember these were pretty much on every street corner, the tasteful cream and brown metallic. Either you love it or you don't, but again, as a three-quarter tonner, it has the large hubcaps, which conceal the full floating rear axle of Dana 70, and this is a full three-quarter ton pickup truck from Oregon, of all places, so it's nice and dry and no rust.
And the consigner says that that camper top in that kind of ribbed swimming pool liner-looking steel has been on the truck since it was new. So this has always been a camper. Imagine where it's been and the stories it could tell.
The caps were a major growth industry in the 1970s. Some were fiberglass, some were corrugated aluminum. This one here by Z-Rig of Medford, Oregon. There were probably hundreds of cap manufacturers. Didn't take much to set up shop. But basically, this one's riveted together, bolted together, but Z-Rig, Medford, Oregon.
These kind of look like your aluminum storm windows from home. This one actually goes up and down. Are we going to get a look inside? Yeah, we are. Well, all the camper gear has been taken out of this one. You see a spare, and the original carburetor and intake manifold are included. And we like to say, if your car's original but it's had modifications, we'll put all that original junk in the trunk, and that will help you on the auction block.
Whenever I say the name of this state, I'm either Oregon or Oregon. You know, I'm going to get hate either way. Just stay away from my piano.
in the sale of this vehicle.
Boy, and you think about how these little camper tops and shells, boy, they were just everywhere during this era, because this was a simple way to make your truck a very versatile vehicle, whether you were hauling stuff around or you were camping in it.
All you need is that that corrugated metal, a couple of pieces of angle, a whole lot of sheet metal screws, and some glue, and you are in the camper business.
This one is a twin tank, and in Ford land, on the driver's side, both tank fillers were located here. In Chevrolet land, Chevrolet thoughtfully put a filler on each side. With that said, if you pull up to the gas pump on this, you're dealing with the driver's side only to fill those two tanks. And again, 79 was the second gas crisis of the 1970s, so gasoline, this probably sat in a lot of lines, a lot of tension in its day, if it could only talk.
And to Mike's point, that might explain why it only has 59,000 miles on it. At first, when they got it, they weren't driving it a lot. And obviously, it was something somebody drove sparingly since 1979. Way it goes, $10,000 for a 1979 Ford F-250 pickup truck. If you'd like to test your collector car knowledge and perhaps grab some great prizes in the process, you're going to want to play the Fantasy Bid brought to you by Dodge. Just go to promo.barrettjacksonfantasybid.com to register and play. You'll try to predict the winning bid of select auction vehicles that will cross the block on Saturday, January 28th. Now, the winner at the end of all four of the 2023 Barrett-Jackson auctions is going to win a very cool grand prize, a 2023 Dodge Challenger. Now, if you're really on top of your game and you could predict the exact final bid of all 12 fantasy bid vehicles, we got something even better. You could potentially win $100,000. It's called the Perfect 12 Jackpot, so make sure you register. Terms and conditions apply. You must be 18 to play. Don't forget, just visit promo.barrettjacksonfantasybid.com for all of the official rules. Welcome back to the Barrett-Jackson Collector Car Auction, day one here in Scottsdale. This is the event we wait for all year long. 1,900 cars, more than that actually, all selling at no reserve. Up on the block now, a 2005 Mercedes-Benz SL500 Roadster.
500 tells us when this one has the 5-liter V8. There are also straight sixes, V12s, but again, this is the V8. Something kind of cool on this is the engineering behind the windshield wipers. This here is double jointed, so the wiper actually has an articulation and almost gets the entire screen covered. So some engineering and detail in everything you look at. But I love the speed lines in the hood and on the sides, which are reminiscent of the original 300 SL of 1953. Beautiful little car.
Yeah, very cool at this point. You know, internally, this was called the R230, which was introduced just a few years before this. It's got the retractable hardtop. You know, it's a long, long way in evolution from the original SL, you know, the 300 SL of the 1950s. But boy, what a great design and how it's had long, long legs over the years.
And you know, this is basically a muscle car, V8. Front engine, rear drive, nice dual exhaust outlets down there, and I just love the effect, you know, the art of the exhaust tip. I hate to, sounds kind of trite, but it is a true fact that the appearance and the impression of horsepower helps to sell cars, and of course it also helps to improve performance, but nice oval outlets on this one, very cool. The exhaust note is cool too.
A lot of technology entering the Mercedes-Benz world at this point, you know, active body control, sensitronic brake control. And that's one of the things, frankly, that holds the price, the resale price down on a lot of these. People are worried about what's going to happen when they break. Having said that, if you get them with the right miles, get them just right, they are great cruising vehicles. Sign the paperwork there for that gentleman. Obviously, he's very happy. He comes away the winning bidder, and the Summit Racing Sold sticker goes on, and away it goes for $10,000. Rolling up behind it, we're going to stay in the 500 SL range from that 2005 we saw just a moment ago to a 2003.
Yeah, this one's similar, but this is a Roadster, not the coupe we just saw, but the same 5-liter V8 with 302 horsepower. And again, those beautiful speed lines, the streaks seen here. And these are metal, not plastic as they might be, say, on a Buick. Not to bust on Buick, but, you know, basically metal construction, nothing faux here. And again, that double-jointed wiper arrangement, which covers just about every square inch of the windshield panel.
Yeah, we were talking about the history of the SL range. You know, when they originally started, it was really a racing car. It was a racing car that was then converted for street use to a slightly different standard. You know, at this time in the SL world, it's really not a race car. They're going racing at Mercedes, obviously very successfully in other series. But the SLs are really luxury cruising cars. They're not designed to be race cars.
Now, the wheels on this are the factory-available AMGs, and while they might look the same, they're actually wider in the back than they are in the front, and it's nice when it's a subtle difference, but that said, you know, the dynamics of this vehicle are improved, and it's hats off to Mercedes for actually taking the time to make wheels that look the same but are actually larger in the back for their purpose of traction and handling.
Yeah, those premium alloy wheels. Now, it's important to point out, and Barrett-Jackson is always very clear about everything. I mean, this has, on the car card, what's called the car card, which is in the window, has a lot of details. Talks about how there was a damage report back in 2015. There was also another damage report in 2016 and some moderate damage reported in 2022. Needless to say, those things are going to hold back the value, as it would in any resale. But the great thing about Barrett-Jackson is when you come here and you see the car card, if that information is available, if it's known, it's listed on the car card up front. There you see it in the windshield, so that anybody who's looking at buying this has all the information they need to make a good decision.
Yeah, the design on this is just beautiful from front to back all the way around. The instrument panel on this is beautiful, this sort of dual shrouded effect right here, tunneled instruments, and just little details that all add up to a very exotic yet approachable personal sports car.
Yeah, 302 horsepower coming from that 5-liter V8. Just enough horsepower to really be able to enjoy the car.
So, $8,500, Mitchell.
2003 Mercedes-Benz 500 SL just sold for $8,500. We're going to check in with Mike Joy.
Shh, we're going to take you backstage. Every day before selling cars, Barrett-Jackson sells automobilia. Rory Brinkman and his group, they have just attracted the greatest in signage, in neon, and in other automobile collectible pieces. There are race trophies. You're going to see outboard motors. You're going to see really cool stuff here, and you can buy it all right here at Barrett-Jackson every morning before they start selling cars. So we'll take you around there backstage, and when we come out here out front to the aisle, you're going to see some of the really cool, really expensive stuff. Gas pumps, kiddie ride. Have you got a dime, sir? Take a ride. You rode these back when you were a kid. So did I. More gas pumps, Ferrari dealer signs, kid rides, oiling stations, an air station. I wanted one of those air pumps. They're almost $2,000 now. How about a Coke machine? Drop your dime, pull the lever, and you'll get one. Would you like to test your weight? Would you like a gas pump? Big boy restaurants. How much time did we spend in those drinking coffee and eating burgers? And more gas pumps. In fact, Barrett-Jackson really has a stake in those. There are a couple really prized lot items, and this is one of them. A good humor truck. Well, not a full-size good humor truck. We've seen those at Barrett-Jackson. But here's one for a dime. You can be the local good humor man, or, dare I say, you could be Batman.
All it takes is a quarter or a dime in the case to ride it. Of course, to buy it, it's going to bring a lot more. You can buy some of that automobilia for just a couple $100 or over $100,000. Be interesting to see what the numbers come up at as the week goes along. A little earlier, we previewed this 2002 Chevy Camaro Z28. It's up on the block right now.
You know, the Camaro is alive and kind of well today, but we've got to remember, this is 2002 right here, and Chevrolet discontinued the Camaro and Firebird at the end of the 2002 model year. A lot of Ford Mustang lovers were happy. Chevy people were not thrilled at all. Of course, Camaro came back in 2010, but here it is, the end of the line for the fourth generation Camaro. This is a good one, though. Z28 means LS1 with 320 horsepower and a 5-speed manual in this one and factory T-tops. And like the Firebird, these have plastic fenders, plastic doors, and a steel hood and body. But good aerodynamics, not a lot of styling on the outside. A lot of folks kind of confuse these with a bar of soap, but they're a great car as long as you're in them. These run a 13-second quarter mile. These are pretty potent cars.
All right, I'm back. I wanted to be Batman, but I didn't have a dime.
Well, all you have to do is raise your bidder's pass, and you can take it home. And then you won't even need the dime. You can bypass that. Congratulations to those folks right there. They just bought that Z28, the Camaro. We're going to take a quick break. There's so many awesome cars that we'll see crossing the block this week here at Barrett-Jackson in Scottsdale.
Barrett-Jackson, the world's greatest collector car auctions, returns to Palm Beach, April 13th through the 15th. Be a part of the action at the South Florida Fairgrounds and consign today. Our pre-qualified bidders want your collector car. Visit Barrett-Jackson.com to get started.
All right, next to the McGuire staging lanes, there are plenty of cars that are pulling up, getting ready to come up onto the block. And if you're a bidder, this is really your last chance to kind of check out the cars before they are up on the block. Get one last chance to look underneath and around before it gets into all the chaos that can be the auction. Up there right now, something really cool, a 1977 Lotus Eclat.
Well, this is fiberglass, proving the point that fiberglass was not reserved only for Chevy Corvettes. In fact, this is a British car. The Lotus, of course, a limited production European sports piece. Four-cylinder Ford Cortina-based dual overhead cam engine under the hood, rear-wheel drive.
Yeah, two-liter engine, but the dual Del Orto carburetors. Only 1,500 of these were produced in their seven-year run, so they are quite rare. Four-cylinder, four-speed car. This does have a vestigial rear seat, so it is a 2+2. Now, this car is set to be on a salvage title. We don't know what happened to it or when. It could be as simple as a recovered theft, or it could have had major damage. That part of its story is unknown, and that will hold back the bidding.
And speaking of stories, Lotus is known for using E for the name of the cars, the Elise, the Elan, the Eclat, Europa, and I don't think there's anything else, just all E's. Gotta love it.
Yeah, this was not from the high horsepower era, although in reality, Lotus was never involved in high horsepower. It was how light could you build the car. The running joke was, you know, they get it down to where it was practically going to fall apart and then just add a pound or two and make it just slightly stronger so it could go down the road.
Yeah, the Elite, the Esprit, just don't call it the Eclair.
$13,900 for that 1977 Lotus. We'll check in with April Rose.
Hey, Rick, I'm with this 1935 Chrysler Airflow Custom. This stunning grille is all about aerodynamics and that Art Deco look. And I absolutely love this hood ornament with the wings shooting back right there. Just a very, very cool look. Now, not a lot of these exist. This is a two-door traveling salesman car, which means it didn't come with a back seat. It's got a 6.1 liter Hemi, automatic transmission, Ford 9-inch rear end, and Wilwood brakes. Just absolutely unreal restoration. Beautifully done ghost green paint. Inside is all complete custom, two-tone light cream and tan, and all that chrome trim is hand done. And I want you to see in the back right here, they got some luggage, fully custom. Beautiful detail with the buckle work and the handle, but it's not what you think. Actually hiding the gas tank back there. Very cool look. Man, I would love to drive this. DeBrule?
Yeah, very nice touch. And by the way, that is actually one of the cars that was part of the Barrett-Jackson Cup. You know, it's a competition for the best in show. They have a car show in addition to the auction. So not only is that part of the Barrett-Jackson Cup, but somebody's going to get to buy it and take it away as well. Up in the block right now, a 1989 Ford F-150 custom pickup truck.
Well, there's a 150. This is a half-tonner, not the 250, which would be a three-quarter tonner. This one, as a result, has the twin traction beam front suspension with coils and not the leaps. But again, this is an extended cab, 8-foot bed, a big one. This this one is a Scottsdale original vehicle, and we can see the original paint still in the bed. Try that in Massachusetts, and it's still even kind of shiny. So a nice, clean desert truck, as we like to say back east in the Rust Belt.
Yeah, in a perfect world here in Arizona, you keep them out of the sun as much as you can, but if as long as it's parked with some covering over it, boy, that paint can last a long, long time.
So $20,000, Merrick.
$20,000 means it's now tied as the number two sale of the day on our very first day here on Monday. We're going to take a quick break here at the Barrett-Jackson Collector Car Auction. Plenty of cars that'll be crossing the block during our full coverage this week. You know, the great thing about Barrett-Jackson, it is an amazing car show in addition to the auction. And if you just buy a general admission ticket, you get to come in, you get to walk around all the cars, an awful lot of them are inside this massive tent, actually series of tents, and then there's plenty of them outside as well. Trust me, you can spend days here going over each and every car. Up in the block right now, a 2004 BMW 645 CI convertible.
Well, we saw Cadillac Eldorados. This is BMW's interpretation of the Executive Express 4.4-liter dual overhead cam V8, six-speed automatic transmission, the bangle butt, and iDrive, which is a controller on the center console, which by twisting and pushing down without looking at that controller, you can operate a lot of the switchgear that way.
One design detail I like on this is how the B pillars have a flying buttress effect, which is very rarely done on convertibles. You got to remember that that recessed rear window and this structure here has to fold and articulate. So that's an engineering complexity that BMW wasn't afraid of. Very cool, the flying buttress on convertibles. Cool.
And here's why they did that, Steve. This glass rear window drops straight down. When the convertible top is down, you can pull that up electrically, just the window, as an air scarf to keep all the cool air from mussing your hair as you go down the boulevard.
$17,000, the hammer price on a 2004 BMW 645 CI. That guy's pumping his fist. He's happy. Let's check in with Tyler.
I'm with Lot 60, a 1930 Ford Model A, and with a blueprint engine cam, let's see what's under the hood. 201 cubic inch four-cylinder. We're going back 90 years here, so everything is pretty simple. You look on the firewall, you have the ignition coil going to the ignition here, the spark plug sticking out. Probably don't want to touch that when it's running, but then you go on the firewall again, you see the fuel. There is a sight glass here to make sure that it is clean, and that's going all the way down to the carburetor here. The green one's for the intake, the gray is for the exhaust. This was 40 horsepower when new, which was good enough in 1930. They sold 4 million Model A's. Of course, the flathead V8 replaced this and started America's thirst for horsepower.
Pretty amazing. I think that's 90 years old, still running to this day. And, you know, the technology's simple, but it gets the job done, keeps that car moving. 2003 Mercedes-Benz SL500 Roadster.
First year for this styling cycle. Now, note the lower front bumper and the way these ribs protrude in this direction with these intakes. That is the part of the AMG styling package, which is optional on these cars and includes those beautiful forged five-spoke wheels, which are chromed as they often were back in the day. Rocker panels are different. You get a little lip spoiler and a different rear valence with kind of a faux diffuser there in the back when you got the AMG package. Steve, beautiful car, but I don't know, 90,000 miles on the clock.
Yeah, the good news is that the dual overhead cams on this V8 are run by chains and not belts on certain Italian engines, you know, Ferraris. And so as a result, they're pretty much good for the life of the engine as opposed to having to be changed out at every 50,000 miles. So that's a strike in the right direction. Now, this is a V8, the 5-liter, 302 horsepower. And a lot of folks, Americans anyways, assume that Mercedes-Benz was always about inline fours and sixes. You got to remember that Mercedes had a V8 engine program all the way in the early 60s. So V8s and Mercedes are definitely not mutually exclusive.
Mercedes mastered the folding hardtop on both their 2 and 2 plus 2 cars, so you had the benefit of a convertible when that top was down, and you had the security of a fixed roof car when it was up. It also had a pop-up rollover bar behind the seats for in case you had an upset when you were driving it with the top down. Very well built, well thought out two-seater.
$15,000 for a 2003 Mercedes-Benz SL500. All that technology, all that styling, and away it goes out into not a lot of sunshine, unfortunately, here in Arizona today. Kind of cloudy. High temperature today here in Scottsdale, only expected to get to 51 degrees. And I got to tell you, for Arizona, that is frigid. Fortunately, as we go through the course of the week, we're supposed to have a lot more sunshine, and the temperature is supposed to be going up slowly. So we're looking forward to a little bit better weather as the week goes along. But the good news is, inside the tent, it's nice and warm, and all kinds of great cars going across the block, like this one, a 2011 Camaro SS.
Well, here we have it, the second year for the fifth generation Camaro. And, you know, they basically sat out 2002 through 2010, but made up for it in a big way. 426 horsepower, six-speed manual transmission. This is a good one.
The Carfax shows this one's had a hit to the left front. We can see evidence of repaint on several panels. No further information given on this one. Big Sumitomo tires on those aftermarket forged wheels. And, of course, four-wheel disc brakes on these.
Thorley exhaust on this one. We see the name Thorley in the side. Of course, Doug Thorley, one of the great header manufacturers of the 1960s, still, of course, in business making aftermarket bolt-on systems like the one seen here. These cars, when equipped with an automatic, only had 400 horsepower. But again, this one here being a manual has the full 426 horsepower.
Rides on black, 20-inch centerline wheels. This Camaro's finished in black with a gray interior. What a beautiful example of a Camaro SS.
11.5, it is a beautiful example. 11.5, 12,000.
Well, that wraps up our first 2 hours of coverage here on FYI. But we have plenty more to come here on Monday at Barrett-Jackson Scottsdale. Two more hours to go. Welcome to Scottsdale, Arizona. We're off to a great start to a huge week here on FYI. Up on the block right now, we've got a 2011 Camaro SS currently bid at $13,500.
A moment ago, I said that these cars only have 400 horsepower. I'm joking. Back in the 1980s, when these had 230 horsepower, it was a big deal. These are great cars, lots of power, and excellent fuel economy, thanks to overdrive, fuel injection, aerodynamics, and this is having your cake and eating it, too. These are great cars.
Yeah, once again, a decade ago, 400 horsepower was an awful lot. I mean, we hadn't envisioned the 700, 800 horsepower beast that we're seeing now. But the concept of getting 400 horsepower in a street car, remember the 70s when we thought that, 160, 180, maybe 200, we could make it 200.
Remember the 5-liter Mustang had 230 horsepower, 225 I think it was. That was a big deal all through the 1980s. And that was enough to put the car in the 14, so 400 is a bunch of power. These are good old days right now.
And then you start getting into the modern EVs where we're combining both the gas and the electric engines. There's all kinds of great stuff going on. $15,000 for a 2011 Camaro SS, 400 horsepower, and away it goes. Rolling up behind it, we got a 2004 Chevrolet. This is a C1500 custom pickup truck.
I think Tyler Hoover referenced this truck a little while ago. This one has the 4.8 liter Vortec, which is very close to an LS. The only thing that's a little bit different, these have iron cylinder blocks as opposed to aluminum on the passenger car type LS. But again, it's same cylinder heads, capable of blowing 300 CFM of air. These are great little big engines.
Yes, and they are junkyard cheap, so if you're not concerned with how much weight is over the front wheels, these are good ones to grab. These and the companion pickup truck 5.3s. But if I'm doing an LS swap, I want an aluminum block motor and save all that weight. So here's another car with a curious history. It had sustained damage in an accident when it was 2 years old and then was rebuilt and done in this red-on-black treatment to custom. And no further details are available. Been treated to extra size forged six-spoke wheels and low-profile tires. I like the color treatment. I just wish I knew more about this car's history.
One detail I like is the five-speed manual transmission, which really connects you to that V8, and you can light those rear tires up anytime. But the beauty, again, is the overdrive fifth gear. Get on the highway and cruise along at 1,600 RPM, saving fuel and the engine.
They still got that truck bed. You can haul things, but the reality is the working days are past for this truck. It's been lowered. It's got those big hoops. Got a nice suede interior with great stitching inside. So really, this is a truck to show and have some fun with if you're one of those people that like to have your daily driver be a pickup truck. I mean, we're currently at $13,500. Got that fun little spoiler on the back. It's got a lot of appeal from a visual perspective.
Yeah, it's got a nice roll pan in the back instead of the rear bumper. It's got bed liner spray in the pickup bed. Dark tint on all the windows. Ready to go.
$13,500 for that 2004 C1500 custom pickup truck. Let's check in with Christian Murphy.
Thank you very much, Rick. You know, I'm getting all of the special guests today, and I'm here with Ryan Friedlinghaus. He is the CEO of the famous, the venerable West Coast Customs. Welcome.
Thank you, thank you.
Now, usually we get a lot of car builders here that come to Barrett-Jackson with beautiful vehicles. You've got one here today, but you're here for a very different reason with a very different mission. Tell us a little bit about this vehicle and why it's so personal to you.
So this truck behind us is a Mazda that was recreated from my childhood. I did my first West Coast Customs Academy program where I had some kids come in free of charge to learn but underneath my guys, and they built this truck that you see.
So the kids were working on the car to rebuild it.
To rebuild it, to make it look just like the truck did when I was 16 years old.
Why is it so important to you to give back? What is the need, or more the opportunity, really, for the industry?
I mean, I feel it's a big void right now. We don't have a lot of new guys. There's not a lot of new workers coming out. So why? And I ask myself this all the time. It's like they've taken out the wood shop and auto shop out of high schools. And why I do what I do today is because I had that. So I want to give the kids that are coming out of high school a chance at this industry that I think is a very lucrative industry for them to be in.
Are we approaching a crisis point at all in terms of the craftsmanship, the skill, the labor in the industry to continue to create beautiful vehicles like this?
Definitely. I definitely feel like it's a big piece that we're missing because everything is so digital. Nobody wants to get their hands dirty anymore.
Ryan, one last question. We've got to go. Where can kids get involved with the Academy?
So they go to my website, westcoastcustoms.com. They can see the West Coast Customs Academy on there. Click the button, and you're good to go.
Wonderful. Very important mission, and thank you very much for taking the time. Rick, my friend, back to you.
Thanks a lot. And I got to tell you, Murph, I'm one of those kids. When I was a senior in high school, I spent 2 hours every day in auto shop as a class. Technically, I was an industrial auto major, so I could learn more, so I could put my hands on cars. It was great. I still have my worksheet from those days. I can tell you the grades I got in my first auto shop class. But it's great that kids back then had that opportunity, and I wish they still did. Up on the block now, a 2012 BMW 650i.
And there's what that retractable rear window looks like when it's down on the flying buttress convertible top on this 34,000-mile BMW.
$17,500. All right, that gentleman gets that car. Time for Corvette number one, the very first Corvette that we're going to see cross the block during our Barrett-Jackson coverage here in Scottsdale. In this case, it's a 1979. It's an L82 T-top.
Yeah, L82 refers to this little emblem on the hood right there. That tells us it's 225 horsepower. The S in the VIN confirms it's a factory L82. The base 350 was like 190 horse. So this is a bunch more power in this one here.
This one's had at least one repaint. Three-speed automatic transmission. The air conditioning compressor and blower have been replaced. There's been a bit of wood grain additions here. But this was your base Corvette for 1979. Urethane bumpers, front and rear, alloy wheels, the horsepower way down due to emissions. But these cars are starting to find an audience. It's a great entry-level way to get into Corvettes.
Yeah, 1979 was an ugly year in a sense. In California, you get a 305 in your Corvette, which is a little depressing. But again, you know, these were not really meant for all-out performance. A bit of both, but a lot of style. So the V8 was a necessity. At least he didn't have a V6 in these things. It was close. They almost did that. But this is the L82, the good one.
And if you couldn't get performance, well, at least you got style, and it definitely appealed. I mean, they sold more than 50,000 of these in 1979. It really dwarfs some of the numbers from earlier. But once again, not a lot of power, but at least you had that style. You had that look. You had a cool, fast-looking car.
And if you look at the back, Detroit was so concerned about emissions and maintaining a low profile, the dual exhaust on this are very well hidden. There are no chrome tips, no square outlets, none of that. This is a time when Detroit and the government are playing hide and seek with performance. So the dual exhaust on this actually is single. There's a catalytic converter on the passenger seat. I won't tell anybody if you don't. But again, the L82 is as good as it got with 225 net horsepower.
Now this one has new BF Goodrich Radial TA tires. It has been repainted. It has a new interior, new power steering box and hoses, front shock, stabilizer links, and it's been freshly aligned. Ready to go.
You know, when we look at this, we think about where we are now with the mid-engine Corvette. And what an amazing evolution Corvette has had. Some would call this the low point right here. I don't say that. These are important. These are bricks in the chimney. These have their place, but it's astonishing to think we have Corvettes right now that go 0 to 60 in 3 seconds, and that's the base model.
And this color, black, number one color during 1979. More than 10,000 black Corvettes were sold of the 53,000 total. $15,500 for a 1979 Corvette L82, the big horsepower model, all 225 horsepower. Coming up in just a little bit, how about a 1929 Model A Roadster? Finished in bright red, love those big white wall tires. Got all kinds of great original touches. We'll see it very soon. Perfect place to enjoy. Well, they got fire out there, little fire pits. They've got great food. It sits right beside the staging lanes. It's a perfect place to enjoy some company, watch the great cars as they roll into the staging lanes before they head up onto the block. And right now we've got a 2005 Audi S4.
One of the strongest four-seat convertibles you can buy with its 4.2-liter V8. Notice what a great job Audi did with the top stack. You don't see any. It is flush here. This is a triple-layer convertible top. Why is that important? Because that means it's very well insulated, both from outside temperature, hot and cold, and from road noise. Great little car here.
Now, Audi was kind of late to the V8 game. They had no V8s in the 50s, 60s, 70s, or even the 80s. In the 90s, of course, Audi discovered the wonders of the torque that you only get from a V8.
You know, Steve, we were talking about horsepower just a little bit earlier. I mean, here we are, 2005, this Audi S4, which, of course, is the sport version, 340 horsepower, really solid. They'll put the sold sticker on, and we'll head out to Tyler Hoover.
Well, I'm with a piece of muscle car royalty right here, a 1970 Hemi Cuda. You look under the hood, it has the iconic engine that was, of course, banned in NASCAR racing in 1965 for probably being too good of its job. They said it's because it wasn't readily available enough yet, but mostly political. Of course, it came back, and it became back in other cars. And by 1970, the Hemi Cuda was probably the one to have with the Hemi. Still, only 700 or so sold of these in 1970 and 71. This one's a beautiful rotisserie restoration in violet. Some say crazy purple, some say violet, but obviously this one done to the nines. We've seen amazing prices with these when they cross the block at Barrett-Jackson.
Yeah, and that is going to be crossing the block later this week. In fact, we have an amazing run-up of cars. Thursday nice, Friday better, Saturday spectacular. In fact, Craig Jackson has his eyes on one particular car he's looking forward to.
Yeah.
We have a 1956 Lincoln Continental Custom. This is a Mark II, which in itself is an ultra rare car. This was the 2015 Good Guys Custom of the Year displayed at SEMA. It has had an enormous amount of work done to it. So custom firewall, floor pans, rockers, shaved door handles. The body was chopped 2 3/4 inches. A John Cost built 520 cubic inch Ford V8 producing 859 horsepower. Now, the interior is another work of art when you look inside of this. Contrasting onyx leather to the lighter inserts. This first rolled in the shop, everybody walked around and went, wow, that's a pretty cool car.
Those Continental Mark IIs are great cars in stock form, and I tell you what, we've seen some amazing custom versions of those as well. They're really a great palette. I love the looks of that one. Up on the block now, we got another Jaguar XJ. This is an XJ6L.
Indeed, a little while ago, we saw some Jags on the block, and this is one with the dual gas tanks here, and of course, right or left, pull up to the pump, you can't go wrong to fill this one up. The exhaust tips on this are kind of weird, I gotta say. They come out, have a bit of a gooseneck here, and that's factory stuff. I'm thinking that Jaguar did that to prevent them from coming straight out and maybe staining the back, or maybe it's stylistic, but that's a stock contour on those pipes right there.
One family owned, passed down through the generations, and just 45,000 miles on this one. Very honest car.
This one is an inline six, and again, to see dual exhaust on an inline six is kind of unusual. It means the engineers decided to do that on purpose. It helps with exhaust breathing. Of course, there's the front of this, that classic styling. I believe that came along in the early 60s on certain Jaguar Mark 5s and 10s, the big saloons, but they stuck with his designs here for many, many years. Classic.
Get a little extra leg room with the XL, and that one just sold to those folks right there for $6,500. The Summit Racing sold sticker goes on, and away it goes for $6,500. From British to German, from Jaguar to Mercedes, 2004 Mercedes-Benz CLK 500 Cabriolet.
So we've seen the two-door SL model, this two-seat SL model. This was the 2+2. Note the same type of AMG styling front air dam. This has a little different style of AMG wheels, but this is only a two-owner car with 51,000 actual miles. Nicely, let me read this again. I'll get back to you on that. There it is, 51,057. So 51,000, very nicely kept.
I like the wheels wide and wider. In other words, you're not going to be rotating the tires on this one, but who cares? Got to love the trail on this. Dual exhaust, beautifully rendered, subtle. Or single exhaust, excusez-moi.
Four-wheel discs. Another great job with the top stack here with these kind of simulated fairings over this hard panel that conceals the convertible soft top.
And of course, this is the CLK, which was slightly smaller in size. Really, it was designed to be kind of a compact and mid-range, although ultimately it kind of ends up in that mid-range style. It had the same look as the E-Class, but on that C-Class chassis.
These are really well-built cars, and I dare say that the depreciation on these is over, and nowhere to go but up. A lot of quality baked into these from the factory.
Yeah, there was also a lot of technology. We talked about it earlier with some of the SLs, and it's that technology that was really kind of in the early days of technology that sometimes can scare off the second or third buyer of the car, and the concern is once the miles start to get up there, although this is pretty darn low mileage at $51,000. It's still a fun cruising car, still rides great. You know, this is the beginning of the second generation of these, and this one just sold for $15,500. Congratulations for a 2004 Mercedes-Benz CLK 500.
If you love cars, then be a part of the world's greatest collector car auctions. Join the enthusiast, the action, the family. We're currently hiring for multiple positions. Put your passion for cars to work. Apply today to be a part of the Barrett-Jackson team.
Not quite sunset here in Arizona, but we're getting close, not far away from it. Up here on the block in Scottsdale, a 1956 Little Gem travel trailer.
And the consigner just ran out of the trailer. He'd been in there turning all the lights on and getting everything lit up. You see there's a fridge and a stove. And wow, what a timepiece this is. But it's got modern connections for water and a pump out. A great vintage trailer that has been kind of resto-modded to be able to use today.
And this one's a Little Gem, not sure the manufacturer, but just like pickup truck caps we talked about earlier, after World War II, all kinds of manufacturers sprouted up to cater to the needs of the growing need and desire for families to go camping. Without a tent, they weren't roughing it. This was considered somewhat luxurious in the 1950s. You weren't getting rained on, you were inside your Little Gem.
You know, earlier when that 75 Ford Granada rolled across the block, I thought, well, now I've seen everything. And as usual, I'm wrong. Maybe now we've seen everything. There's about 8 paragraphs of descriptions of everything that's been added to this and modernized. All new 12-gauge wiring for 110 volts, a Group 27 deep cycle battery. There's the propane cans on the front. And the manufacturer was Scheiboat. I'm probably mispronouncing that, but they were in Grand Rapids, Michigan. Little Gem is the model, and this was serial number 2029.
Tell you what, there is a strong group of people who love to redo these. No shortage of YouTube videos of people going through, and they're like pallets. You know, you can go through and you can kind of make it semi-original looking inside, which is sort of what they've done here. I'm going to call this one a resto mod. It looks stock from the outside, and even when you first glance inside, what it hides, though, there's a nice TV in there, there's a nice air conditioner, much more creature comfort than it had when it was brand new in 1956. Well, that lady's happy. $16,000 for a Little Gem travel trailer. Rolling up behind it, we're gonna have a 1970 Chevy El Camino, and we're gonna squeeze in some Haggerty fast facts on this. The El Camino, the SS edition, debuted back in 1968. El Camino means the road or the way, if you translate it in Spanish. And the El Camino went through a major restyling in 1968 that led to this body style. The engine, well, it maxed out at 450 horsepower in 1970.
Little details, of course, the El Camino, based on the station wagon frame with boxed side members. This one's not a super sport, just a 350, but most of them were. But a nicely presented example.
Well, this one's had a bit of a rough time with the panel fit on the left side. Indicates perhaps some sort of mishap somewhere along the way. And the hood is closed. Otherwise, we show you a look at that small block V8 and the TH350 automatic. Re-chrome bumpers, new interior, new vinyl top, spray-in bed liner, rebuilt carburetor, and a new starter.
And about that frame, these are body-on-frame vehicles like our Chevelles, but something different about the El Camino and the convertible is that the side frame rails were not C-channel, but rather they were fully boxed. Chevrolet expected that people would have as much as 500 or 600 pounds of weight in the back, and they wanted the frame to resist the temptation to twist.
The front license plate would have you believe this was an original California blue plate car. And 1970 is the last year for the quad headlights on El Camino. These 4 5¾-inchers would give way to a pair of 7-inch headlamps in 1971.
A little later this week, we're going to have a 1970 El Camino LS6 coming up onto the block. That is a very special and rare machine.
development detail about the El Camino is that it still has the vent windows in the doors that were last seen in 68 on two-door hardtops. But again, a little tiny thing that makes the El Camino a little bit different from its hardtop brethren.
Came close to $20,000, $19,500 for that El Camino. We're going to head out to April Rose.
Your body is a wonderland. There, I said it. This car was once owned by singer John Mayer, 2006 Ford GT in the sweetest heritage colors. Now, what I love about these is they're super easy to drive and they're pretty reliable for a supercar. 5.4 liter supercharged V8, 6-speed manual. Now, they were styled after the GT40s that absolutely dominated Le Mans in the 60s. And the GT40s, they sat at about 40 inches high, okay? This generation is 44 inches high. And get this, engineers asked designer Camillo Pardo to raise the back end even higher to satisfy what they wanted to achieve for aerodynamics. Now, Pardo refused. He said it was already too high, and the compromise was to add this tiny lip back here, just under an inch. So now you know what it is when you see it. When you're designing cars like this, every millimeter counts. DeBrule?
Looks like a gurney flap right there, as a matter of fact. Dan Gurney, famous for inventing that. All right, that's a car that you're going to see on Saturday. Another interesting car, and I mean wild. Well, let's let Craig Jackson and Tyler Hoover tell you about it.
This is turbine-powered lot number 1324. Tyler Hoover is here from Hoovy's Garage. This is the world's only turbine-powered Batmobile based off the 1989 Batman film.
Growing up, this was the Batmobile, you know, of my generation. Tim Burton, Michael Keaton.
Yep.
I had the model of this car, the poster. This is close to what it would have been if this was a real life car.
Because it actually has a turbine powered it, which is pretty cool.
So I believe he started with a 1985 Corvette. Obviously, the wheelbase is
stretched just a touch.
Just a touch. It's a Boeing turbine in this thing. I believe a helicopter motor.
385 horsepower coming out of it. 0 to 60, they say, in 3.9 seconds. And he reported did 185 miles an hour.
That's
where I would love to know.
So it was actually unveiled about 10 years ago at the Alt Park Concours d'Elegance, where it won 3 awards. Now, this Batmobile was completed by Pooch Racing and was the only one made turbine motor. The bodywork is made from both fiberglass and aluminum with a steel cockpit chassis. It uses a 4-gear semi-automatic sequential shifted transmission, and it has a stereo, air horn, and approved turn signals, taillights, and headlights. So you can drive this thing.
Yeah, like we're going to. Buckle up, we're going for a ride.
Waiting for 3,500. 3,500 flips that way. On. 10,000 to flip it off. Magnets to 15,000. Let it flip that off. Oh my God. 14, 15. All right, we're live. Now, we're off. All right. Batmobile. I'm Batman.
What an awesome tribute. I mean, that's exactly what the movie car felt like when you imagine driving it, mm-hmm. seeing it in the film. Just nuts.
And you know, the interesting story is the guy who built that didn't have any blueprints. He did it all just by looking at the one from the movie and kind of imagining the dimensions.
Oh my God, it's like Galaxy Quest on wheels.
In every way.
Get out the historical documents. We'll build one.
From one extreme to the other, from a Batmobile to a Model T.
Well,
up front, we see the Armstrong starter right here. It's as strong as your arm is. You spin that baby over. No front brakes on Model T. And again, these are made for the days before the interstate highways of the post-World War II era. So this is also known as a telephone coupe, wherein it's very tall. The phone booth kind of a look on that. But next to last year for the mighty Model T before the Model A replaced it in 28.
Straight axle front end, no front brakes, and cable-operated rear brakes. Four-cylinder engine, two-speed manual transmission. 177 cubic inch engine. Maybe we'll have to take a break so we can find some pictures or video to explain what many of our viewers, what a phone booth is.
You got to remember, too, there was a time when Henry Ford said you can have your Model T in any color you want as long as it's black. Well, by this time, they were available in two-tone color combinations like this. But it is true, early on, they were always painted black. It was the paint that would dry the quickest and gave them a classy look. But again, Henry Ford, any color you want as long as it's black. Well, not so true by this point in time.
And up front, you know, you showed that crank handle right there. That's how you started it. And unfortunately, every now and then, if you were cranking it and it kicked back, there were more than a few people who ended up with broken arms because that thing could swing back right at you.
And broken teeth as well. Yeah, stories abound.
Yeah, the guy who invented the electric starter, the story was Kettering, the guy who did it, had a buddy who broke his arm. He thought, well, there's got to be a better way. So he came up with the electric starter. $9,000 for a 1926 Ford Model T. He looks pretty happy. Don't forget, go to Barrett-Jackson.com. We've been talking a lot about the cars that are going to be crossing the block later this week. That's where you can see the full list of cars, the entire docket, as it's called, before they get here. Barrett-Jackson.com. A little while ago, we previewed a 1929 Ford Model A. It's up on the block right now. We just saw the Model T. Now it's time for the Model A.
One thing I love about the Barrett-Jackson auction block, it's more than an auction. It's also a classroom. The Model A has front drum brakes, which were standard equipment for 28 on. And the starter was electric. You still had a hole for override if you needed it. The battery went dead. But a lot of advances in the Model A from 28 onward.
So still a hole for the crank. Check here on top of the radiator. This is a Royce Moto meter. It is a water temperature gauge. You look at it from this side so the driver can see what the water temperature is because there is no such gauge on a Model A Ford, so you can read it right out there.
And here at the back, this is a rumble seat roadster. And the rumble seat, of course, is about the seat mounted here. And getting in and out, you think, wow, don't step on the fenders. Well, there were two aluminum foot pads right here on the bumper. One step, second step, and in you go.
I'm not sure about the bright yellow on the wheels. My dad had one of these, and he painted the wheels in zinc chromate primer, an aircraft industry finish, which was similar in color, but not quite the glossy presentation. This one has been updated with modern park and turn signal lights and wind wings. Note those accessory windows that are etched to the side of the windshield. Without those, the wind comes to the windshield and it comes over it and around it and just blasts you in the face. The wind wings prevent that.
Yeah, the Model A was the result of an over 1 year long shutdown of the Ford River Rouge plant. Model Henry Ford said, hey, we're shutting this thing down after the Model T. And everybody wondered what's up. And it was about a 12-month gestation with no production at River Rouge. But when they got up to speed on the 28 Model A, they didn't stop.
Can you imagine that happening today? Imagine Ford, Chevrolet, Chrysler shutting down a factory for a year to retool. Now there's almost no turnaround time when they do that, very little. But back then, over a year it had to be shut down.
Yeah, if you're in Detroit, go to the Rouge plant. They do trucks there, I believe, now, but I've been through that. As a guided tour, you can go there as a member of the public. It's fascinating to see how vehicles are built. Go if you get a chance.
Wow. 1929 Ford Model A, really nicely done. $15,000, the hammer price. That's what it's going to sell for. Remember, they're going to add on a 10% buyer's premium to that as well. Coming up, something a little bit faster. How about a Porsche Speedster recreation? This one's got a 2-liter four-cylinder engine. It's got dual carburetors, four-wheel disc brakes. We'll see that very soon. The McGuire staging lane has plenty of cars standing by, waiting to pull up onto the auction block. In fact, that Porsche Speedster recreation we talked about just a few moments ago is out there. That'll be up in the block very soon. We got Hummers, we got Mercedes, we got pickup trucks. Love that Buick in the back, all standing by. It'll be up on the block very soon. Remember, this is just day one of our auction. We got 4 hours of coverage today, and as the week goes on, the quality of the cars, the prices of the cars will be going up. On the block right now, a 1987 Chevy C10 Custom.
Well, the square body Chevy pickups are red hot right now. 1987, the final year right here. 88 would bring us the GMT 400. Now, this grille looks like it's a really cool factory accessory. This is a metal aftermarket, which the headlights hide behind it. Not something sold by Chevrolet, but looks really cool. And seen on probably one out of every 20 pickups back in the day when these things were sold new. Cool.
Yeah, this is cool. Fiberglass cowl induction hood. It's got a fabricated front bumper, and it is a step side. Now all we see are smooth side pickups, but this is a true step side with a rectangular pickup bed rather than one where the wheel wells intrude into the bed like on most pickups today.
It's got a big block, 454 cubic inches underneath. You know, this is really, once again, a truck that's kind of coming into its own in the collector world. I mean, if it was 20 years earlier, it'd bring 20 years older, it'd be bringing more money, but I tell you what, for the money right now, a solid collectible. 1987 Chevy K10, $16,000. The lady with the sold sticker having to reach way up to write the price on it as it goes away. All right, tons of great cars, tons of good collections here at Barrett-Jackson. And Mike Joy's got a preview of a very special one, the Boyd Collection.
Here are some of the beautiful original cars coming out of the Boyd Collection in North Carolina. This 59 Cadillac two-door DeVille hardtop, green metallic with green cloth upholstery, a beautiful car. And the next owner will put the 30,000th actual mile on this one. Let's go back to 1955. How about a beautiful two-tone Chevy Bel Air in black and white, white and black upholstery, three on the tree manual transmission, 265 cubic inch V8, and only 16,000 original miles. How about this beautiful baby bird, 1955. This one still has the original paper on the lower door panels and the plastic surrounding its original seat, all but showroom fresh. And since this collection is bookended by Cadillacs, 1956 in the special Mountain Laurel paint job, Mountain Laurel Pink, and Arlington Green. This one just turned 36,000 miles. You like your classic cars all original? You're gonna like the Boyd Collection.
Now that first car, that mint green 59 Caddy, sustained a little bit of cosmetic damage in transit here to Scottsdale, so we won't see it later this week, but it should be on the block in Palm Beach in April.
Just a little delayed gratification. We look forward to that. Look forward to that, especially in Palm Beach. 2000 Ford Excursion Custom VIP conversion up on the block.
The Excursion was Ford's effort to go after the Chevy Suburban full-size SUV market. Not made for many years, but this one has something crazy under the hood. A V10, the Triton 6.8-liter V10, which tells us and proves that V10's not just for Dodge Vipers. This one is a VIP conversion, and inside some custom seating. And let's have a look here at the reverse-facing back seat. Sort of a VIP presidential, sort of a conversion inside. Not factory, but pretty cool. A lot of luxury.
Interesting piece and interesting rear door treatment on this one. We're used to seeing either a tailgate with a window that raises and then a tailgate that folds down, or the Chevy Suburban has the big barn doors. This is kind of a hybrid in that the rear window lifts up and then these two short doors open out. Why do you do that? Because if you have an old back like mine and you're carrying a heavy load, you don't want to have to load it in over the tailgate. You want to walk right up to the bumper and set it down.
Yeah, not even lean over that tailgate, right? So $7,200 for that VIP conversion done on a 2000 Ford Excursion. All that custom work. Away we go, but we promise we're coming back.
The all-new line of Barrett-Jackson merchandise and apparel is now available. From road rallies to the office, there are many stylish options for the car lover. Available year-round or online at shopbarrettjackson.com.
No shortage of excitement here at Barrett-Jackson in Scottsdale. No shortage of great cars, and Tyler Hoover's found yet another.
Yes, I'm with lot 86, a 2006 Bentley Continental Flying Spur. And with the blueprint engine cam, let's take a look at what's under the hood, a 6-liter W12. Now, this was developed after Volkswagen purchased Bentley, and they took the VR6 motor and made it into a W12. So it's staggered cylinders and a sort of W shape back and forth, and that resulted in 551 horsepower with the twin turbochargers. This made it the fastest production four-seat car in the world at the time. An amazing development, but from humble beginnings.
Yeah, that is very cool. And that's such a great looking view of that from up above. It just looks nicely designed on pretty much every level. Mechanical marvel, and down below it looks cool. 2007 Mercedes-Benz SL550 Roadster.
All right, so this one is the normal version without the AMG front and rear bumper covers and wheels. I hate to call this a base model, but that's what it is. In white over stone, very popular color combination, 75,000 actual miles.
This one being a 550 versus the 500s we saw earlier, has a 5.5 liter engine versus 5.0, so about 340 inches versus 302. You got to love this articulated hardtop here that folds down, glass panel, just wonderful engineering in practice here.
Concord is in New Hampshire. Concord is in North Carolina. A lot of race teams there. Not sure where Concordville is, but that's where this car is from.
You know, interesting, it's the SL550 in the United States. This same engine in Europe, I believe, was actually being sold as the SL500. They never changed the designation. I think it was exclusive to North America where they were calling it the SL550.
All right, hold those calls, please. This wears Pennsylvania inspection stickers. Perhaps that's where Concordville is.
Well, for a Pennsylvania car, which potentially could be subjected to a little bit of winter art, looks very crisp. I always look at the hubs to make sure there's no flash rusting on them, and these are still gray like they would have been from the dealership, so it's been stored indoors almost certainly.
Yeah, with 75,000 miles, it's been used but not abused. It's not way over the mark, but at the same time, it's sometimes you don't like to see something that is too low on mileage. It's been sitting for too long.
This does have the optional glass center roof section. And I'm not sure if at this point, 2007, it was photochromic, so you could, you know, dim the amount of light intensity that came through. But it was a bit of a different look, and it's a glass panel. There is a cloth screen underneath to help take away some of those harmful UV rays.
Yeah, living in Arizona, we still like a hard top, but we don't want any photochromatic coming through.
And on this one, the front and rear wheels are not staggered. In other words, they're the same size in terms of diameter and width. And the tires are also the same. So if you're frugal, you can rotate these tires and wheels if you choose to. But again, on the AMGs, you'd see a staggered large and larger effect on the wheels.
Well, that 2007 Mercedes-Benz SL550 just sold here at Barrett-Jackson. Wait a minute, did it sell? Look, I heard the hammer come down. But we're still moving. We're at $16,000.
And a bit of a bargain, Rick. You know, this was nearly a $100,000 car new. It's got a lot of life left in it, so I think somebody just made a good buy.
They haven't bought it yet. I guess we finally sold it at $16,500. One last bid that came from the skybox. A little while ago, well, we'll go out to Christian Murphy first.
Thank you very much, Rick. Well, I feel the need for speed. Not something you would normally associate with a Bronco, unless, of course, these two here. Well, they're nicknamed Maverick here and Goose on the other side here. They are beautiful 1970 Ford Bronco custom SUVs. And that part about the speed, well, they're both fitted with 5-litre Coyote crate engines matched to a 10-speed auto transmission. Both are lifted 5.5 inches, but don't worry about getting into them because both have a beautiful power step to get you up into a beautiful, sumptuous interior. The craftsmanship in these vehicles is absolutely extraordinary. And I love the colors, the teal sort of blue color and the blue color on the right, I should say, with Maverick, and the limey color there on the left with the Goose. And check the markings. You probably can't see them there, but they both have individual markings. Maverick down the sides and then the Goose along the wheel arches. These are two beautiful vehicles, and they have each had 1,400 hours put into them to get to this level of quality. There's a lot of Broncos here, Rick, at Scottsdale, and these are two of the best that I have seen out here.
Yeah, and those will be up on the block on Saturday, Super Saturday here at Barrett-Jackson. They're full spectrum. And we've got an original 29,000-mile Survivor, and then we've got a brand-new Raptor edition. So it's the full range of Broncos. A little while ago, we previewed this 1955 Porsche Speedster recreation.
Well, recreation it is. It's a 73 Volkswagen chassis, and we see here what looks like a Porsche crest, but look closely, Fiberfab Speedster. Fiberfab was one of the earliest fiberglass replica body manufacturers, the Fiberfab Avenger GT40 replica of the 70s. So basically, it's a fiberglass tribute to a 356 Speedster. Of course, Speedster being the stripped-down version, swept back windshield frame, built for the American market, but a fun little buggy.
Yeah, a lot of the real ones found their way quickly to the racetracks of America and the SCCA races. This has a fiberglass body, all big blistered fenders. No crying, please. No Porsches were harmed in the creation of this car. This is a 73 Volkswagen underneath. Nicely done, you know, for show and go, but no one will confuse it with the real deal.
And there's the Volkswagen engine. It has been hopped up with Weber's right and left. The stock engine would have had a single carburetor, so it's been breathed on. Probably about, 90 horsepower. Plenty for this little 2,000-pound rocket.
In 1973, not one of the most popular Volkswagen Beetle years, so turning it into a nice-looking Porsche Speedster recreation, I think it's no harm, no foul. It's kind of an upgrade when you get right down to it.
It's good to see Brembo brakes all the way around. Of course, Brembo does sell conversion kits for just about any application, including universal fit stuff. So the Brembos are a nice touch.
Well, solid money makes that the number one sale of the auction today. $25,000 for a 1955 Porsche Speedster recreation with those Weber carbs, four-wheel disc brakes, and away it goes. A little bit of a chilly day out in the McGuire's staging lane. Temperature today here in Arizona, only about 51 degrees. Got a little bit of a cloud cover, but still all kinds of great machinery that's going through. Just throw on a sweatshirt, throw on a coat. Come out and enjoy Barrett-Jackson if you're in the neighborhood. If not, well, then we want you to watch every single day and every hour of coverage that we have on FYI and the History Channel. 2005 Chrysler Crossfire SRT6 convertible.
Oh, these are an outgrowth of the Daimler Chrysler partnering, if you want to call it that. And these, of course, have Mercedes underpinnings, V6 engine. And I love how the stripes in the hood sort of remedy or go back to the Chrysler Airflow design of the 1930s. But a tasteful little creature, but again, never really took off. But maybe the best days are ahead of it is a collectible.
I think so, Steve. This is a 2005, and it rides on the previous generation Mercedes SLK two-seater chassis with its V6 and independent suspension, automatic transmission, of course. Carfax, it's a clean Carfax, which also shows all the maintenance records for this car since it was new. This looks pretty showroom fresh.
Now, the one thing that sets this one apart is the SRT6 level of trim and engine supercharger on that V6. So that sets this one apart. And again, the SRT6 has this. Now, SRT, of course, was and is Chrysler's street and racing technology division. Not street racing, take it to the track, but SRT6, this is the muscle version right here, the one you want.
One other rather rare and expensive option on this one is set to have factory navigation system. Really early iteration of that. There's the CD changer, FM radio, the rocker switches. Sharp little two-seater, fun. Not particularly fast, not particularly a great handler, but a fun car.
It's a good cruiser. I tell you what, though, immediate love. This shot up to $25,000, been sitting there for a while. But whoever wanted this or the two people who wanted this, they knew what they wanted.
The wheels on this are staggered, of course, wide and wider, and the headrest have SRT6 stitched into them, so this is the good one.
Well, $25,000 means that is now tied as the number two sale of the day and of the auction. In fact, let's take a look at our Hagerty top five. We got that 1968 Buick GS400 that sold just a moment ago while we were in our commercial break, the Speedster, the Crossfire, a Jaguar XK convertible, followed by a Chevy Silverado. I believe that was a custom that sold. That's our top five. Let's check in with April Rose.
Check out this 1959 Brookwood custom wagon. Tons of chrome. Lots of customization in the engine bay here. So many man hours went into this build. I want you to check out all this chrome along the side. They even shaved the rocker panels down here. Now, my favorite part about these are the bat wings that come across, and also 1 year only are these cat eye tail lights. Of course, you got the black California plate. It's got an LS3 4L60E trans, EC air, E-level ride, and staggered wheels, giving it a sweet stance. Now, inside, it's got full custom glide bucket seats, original style 1959 plaid inserts, and a really cool one-off set of classic instrument gauges, and oh, just a sick sound system. I mean, that might be the most important part, right, DeBrule?
I'll tell you what, that Brookwood has come a long way from the condition that it left the factory in. Beautifully done on every level. Nice little low slam to the ground. We'll be right back in just a moment.
Barrett-Jackson, the world's greatest collector car auctions, returns to Palm Beach, April 13th through the 15th. Be a part of the action at the South Florida Fairgrounds and consign today. Our pre-qualified bidders want your collector car. Visit Barrett-Jackson.com to get started.
Westworld is packed this afternoon. Plenty of people, plenty of cars, plenty of things to do, in fact. You know, this isn't just an auction. It's really an automotive lifestyle event. There's great cars to see. There's great vendors to have some fun with. You cannot go wrong. I know a lot of people I talk to, this is the auction they want to come to. And I can tell you, if you're a car person, this is absolutely the place to be. Right now, we got a 1969 Mustang Custom.
Well, the Mach 1 arrived in 1969. First example here, standard hood pinch. You could delete them if you wanted to. But these cars gave you most of the look of a Shelby Mustang at about, 70% of the price. These kind of helped to kill the Shelby right here.
However, this is not an original Mach 1. It's a base Mustang sports roof that has been reimagined as a Mach 1 with the proper hood, with the scoop, with the stripes, with the spoilers. It's the Mach 1 look, and look at the money. We're at $50,000 and climbing.
Let's have a peek with the chassis cam under this beautiful 6.9 Mustang. And here's the underside of that 351 small block, four-speed manual top-loader transmission, H-pipe exhaust, nicely detailed underneath. Flowmaster mufflers, 9-inch rear axle. Looking good.
This is amazing. I never would have thought $57,000 for this recreation. Steve, how can we tell that it wasn't born a Mach 1?
Well, the thing of it is, you want to go to the trim tag and look at the style number. In 70, you actually had that data baked into it. This just tells us the fastback, the 02. But again, it's nicely done. All the right stuff is on it. Looks good.
Well, I think the point here, Mike, is that it looks like the real thing. You're going to spend a little bit less. It's got everything you could ask for.
Oh, you're right. It has a 351 V8 and a four-speed. So the builder here has done a great job because he took a $25,000 car and turning it into a Mach 1, he's more than doubled his money.
Yeah, the style tag says 63C, so it's a regular fastback, a 2 plus 2. It is, however, transmission code 5, factory 4-speed, so that's cool.
Well, this is easily the number one sale of the day so far, blowing away number two. We're closing in on 60 grand. Are we gonna make it?
Hammers high.
Came close.
Oh, wait a second.
Hold the car.
Now, once again, the auctioneer, it's the captain of the ship. Even though he has hit the gavel, if he hasn't said sold, then he has the ability to say, okay, wait a minute. Because sometimes there's confusion. You can have two different people who think they have the high bid.
Just a reminder, folks, make sure if you raise your hand, you've got a bidder credential on. We've got a lot of people out there, a lot of confusion. If you don't have a bidder credential, we'll be happy to get you one, but do not wave and bid if you don't have a bidder credential.
So there are bidder assistants all the way to the back of the hall and up into the muscle lounge, and they relay bids to the auctioneer on the block. It's a long way to the back there, so there can be a bit of confusion, and usually the auctioneer will reopen the auction just to the two final bidders until he gets a winner.
Gotta love the rear valance with the dual exhaust poking through.
So apparently one of the bids that was recognized was someone waving to a friend in the audience. That's why they had to recheck and back up to the last legit bid.
Or potentially somebody who was bidding but didn't have the bidder's pass. And the Summit Racing Soul Sticker goes on, and away it goes at $55,000 for that really nice 69 Mustang Custom Coupe. Vintage is strong right now, rolling up behind it. How about a 1959 Chevy Impala Custom?
Well, this is a first year for these crazy horizontal fins on the full-size Chevrolet. And again, a 502 big block under the hood. Not something that came there from the factory, but what a neat resto mod.
Wow, triple black Impala. That was the top of the line Chevrolet beginning in 1958. And this styling cycle, as Steve said, new for 59. A lot of upgrades under hood. I love the almost triple black treatment here because all that gleaming stainless, as you go toward the back of the car, once you get past the doors, there's that beautiful red stripe. That is factory, denoting the Impala for all who would look. What a beautiful bubble top here.
It's a radical change, this 59 versus the 58, which came before. Well, the word is that Chevrolet and GM stylists saw the 57 Chrysler cars. The forward look car says, hey, let's skip that 58 altogether and get right down to business and take them on head-to-head. And so if you look at this thing, you'll see a lot of Virgil Exner styling touches kind of hinted at here. But again, it is truly a Chevrolet, and I love the dual antennae on the back. Only one actually works, but what a fantastic design.
Just the way everything ties together right here at the center of the trunk above the license plate where all that stainless trim ties together. We've got a new top seller, Rick.
We're at 68, now $70,000.
This one has a Ford 9-inch rear axle upgrade.
Four-wheel disc brakes, Krager SS style, or those torque thrust style wheels. They were similar. And of course, that beautiful two-door bubble top body style.
You know, to your point, Steve, this is just 2 years removed from that iconic 1957 Bel Air look. This could not be more different in the automotive styling world. And it's just 2 years later.
Well, at least two bidders have been waiting all afternoon for this one to come to the block. $75,000. You know, they raced these on the high banks of Daytona in 1959. Junior Johnson and others drove these. And no, the big gull wing rear fenders and fins would not lift the car off the ground at speed.
And look at this. Look how the sheet metal's tortured into these forms. I mean, it's an astonishing thing. There are a lot of seams that are covered up by lead here, but wow, look at that. These are mass-produced. This is not a handmade car. Chevy made hundreds of thousands of these. Amazing
design.
This is
truly just a one-year look. I mean, the next year, 1960, much more subtle because it was probably very expensive to produce. And that is now the number one seller of the day here on Monday at Barrett-Jackson. $76,000 for a 1959 Impala custom coupe.
Rick, there were a number of people when Barrett-Jackson said, we're going to sell cars on Monday. We've never done that. We're going to do it. I know consigners who said, oh, I don't know. They've never done that before. I wonder if the bidders will be there. Here's proof. They're here.
You bring the car, the bidders are there. In fact, Craig Jackson wants to show us a car that I'm sure the bidders are going to be very interested in.
We have a 1951 Hudson Wasp custom coupe, and a custom it is. This is one of the more unusual customs we've ever seen. It was built by Kenny's Rod Shop in Boise, Idaho. They started from scratch on this Hudson, designing a custom frame, put new floorboards in it and rear wheel tubs to give it the proper stance while retaining full drivability. The Viper V10 engine is a 8.3 liter with a Hogan Racing intake manifold and custom headers, 6-speed manual transmission, modernization inside of the cabin, also a mix of brown and basket weave Alcantara leather. Your opportunity to pick up a beautiful custom, you'll be the only one to have one, the Viper engine under the hood.
Amazing mix of old and new. And once again, that is one of the cars we'll see crossing the block later this week as both the quality and the prices go up and up and up. And now on the block, another big car with big money, 57 Cadillac Eldorado Biarritz, and we've hit 60,000. We're still going.
These are notable in so many ways. Again, final year for single headlights in Cadillac. Quads would come along for 1958. The Dagmar front bumpers, a reference to an actress who had a very pointy nose. And the wheels, of course, are saber spoke aluminum wheels. Those aren't hubcaps. These are actually forged aluminum wheels, some of the first of their kind in mass production.
Beautiful two-door convertible, white top, black and white upholstery, $82,000 bid. And notice this car does not say Cadillac anywhere on it. On the front fenders and the trunk, it just says Eldorado or Biarritz.
And those tail fins are so crazy. They contrast with the rounded whale-like back of it with those distinctive fins standing out all on their own, an effect only seen on the Eldorado in 1957.
You know, we've got a Batmobile recreation of the 1989 version coming up later this week, but the tail fins on this kind of have a Batman look to me. Look at that, $83,000 for a 1957 Cadillac Eldorado Biarritz. He'll sign the paperwork. Remember, he also has to pay a 10% buyer's premium, and he gets to drive away that car. Boy, the numbers just suddenly moving up and up and up. That's now the number one sale of the day. And if you want to track all the cars that have sold today, just go to Barrett-Jackson.com. You can see all the cars that have already sold and the cars that are yet to cross the block here at Barrett-Jackson. Up on the block right now, how about a 1971 Camaro Z28 RS?
That's the year I had. I did not have the RS. Those of you that don't like today's BMW M4 grill, is this where they got the idea? This is the RS nose with the urethane grill surround and the round lights. There's your small block Chevy, albeit this one with headers. By the way, my long-lost 71 Z28 has been found. We're going to show you more about that later in the week. But this one's been given a cowled induction hood. good, Steve. But aside from that, in the headers, looks pretty stock.
Now, these wheels might look like bolt-on mags, but these are actually stamped steel wheels with an aluminum, or some magnesium look in the middle. They're kind of heavy, and that chrome trim ring snaps off, but that is a stamped steel wheel, but it sure looks like magnesium to me. First seen in 1970.
And that was stock on the Z28, which was the only Camaro you could get with 15-inch wheels. Now, being a 71, the tall rear spoiler, the three-piece spoiler was optional. This is the emblem that belongs on the low one-piece spoiler. This should be a Mylar decal on the tall spoiler. Mulsanne blue is the color. Mulsanne is the four-mile-long straightaway at Le Mans, France.
This one is a four-speed, hallelujah. You could get an automatic in your Z28 starting in 70, but this one's a wide ratio. What does that mean? Well, unlike the close ratio, this has a 2.52 to 1 first gear, a little more torque multiplication versus the 2.20 of the close ratio, and better around town.
This would have been born with a 373 to 1 posit traction rear end and a factory rear sway bar, which I see is still in place today.
Tell you what, the room has come alive with this collection of cars that are crossing the block right now. The prices have jumped tremendously. We're at $45,000 for that 1971 Camaro Z28 RS Edition. Those folks right there come away the winners. Congratulations. And coming up, how about a 1964 Buick Riviera Custom? Yeah, it's got that Wildcat 465 cubic inch V8 engine under the hood. Well, moments ago, we got our first six-figure car of Barrett-Jackson Scottsdale in 2023. The 71 Cuda, 340 with just 39,000 original miles, rocked the block. Hammer came down $100,000, making it the number one sale of the auction so far, and absolutely the number one sale of the day.
Rick, that may well be a record for a 340 hardtop Cuda. Wow.
Up in the block now, a 2012 Camaro 2SS. A lot of custom touches, current price $27,000, $28,000.
Well, the fifth generation Camaro returned in 2010, and in 11, the convertible came along. So second year here for the convertible. Has been modified quite a bit. Underneath that fiberglass hood is an Edelbrock E-Force supercharger on top of the 6.2. So it's gotta be 500 plus horsepower, but I'm loving the six-speed manual transmission in this one.
All but factory fresh, the odometer on this one shows under 4,600 actual miles.
And I love the style bar that they put into this. It's got a nice real touch, especially the fact that it's got, you know, similar to the body color. A lot of nice custom touches that just make this stand out.
Consigner does describe that a boxed frame has been added along with the style bar to help reinforce the body against twisting from the torque of the engine. I mean, these are pretty rigid as they are, but it's a nice extra to bolster it additionally with the added blower.
You know, a standard Camaro with regular mileage would go for about half of what this is selling for right now. So strong money because it's beautifully prepared. And as Mike mentioned, less than 5,000 miles on the odometer, $44,000 for a 2012 custom Camaro. Let's check in with Tyler Hoover.
Well, I found a very rare Ferrari here in the salon selling later this week. It's a 2001 Ferrari 550 Barchetta, which the name Barchetta dates back to the 1940s, and it was originally called a small boat, but they applied it to their sports cars as well. So this one is a convertible. The 550, they were mostly coupes. They only made about 400 of these convertibles, and there's no top. You're basically clipping on a toupee when it rains. It does look a little unattractive with the top up, but with the top down, this Pininfarina styling is absolutely gorgeous. You have a V12 under the hood, 485 horsepower, but inside is what makes these really special to me. This is the last V12 Ferrari to be offered with only a gated manual transmission, which you can see right there. And one of the people to row that gated manual, well, it's musician Rod Stewart. Rock icon, was previously owned this Ferrari 550. So a cool car and a great story.
Yeah, celebrity lineage can add to the value, especially if it's the right celebrity. In this case, Rod Stewart. Well, it'll be very impressive to see what this does when it gets up onto the block. Very rare car. Up there right now, we got a 68 Camaro SS recreation.
Indeed, we see the SS emblem in the grill. We see the 396 emblems on the front fenders, but none of that is proven to be original. All we know is the VAN starts with a 124, so it was a V8 car, but that was then. But I like what they've done. 12-volt, 4-speed, so it's mechanically up to snuff.
Yeah, blue over blue, 68. Steve, to my memory, those Z28 stripes were not available on any other Camaro. So maybe this is a greatest hits edition. Love the Le Mans blue color. And they built a nice car.
Well, it's true. You know, in some cases, fantasy following fact, that cowl induction hood on this one, that never came along until 69. This is a steel recreation available readily from the aftermarket. So again, if it's popular enough to have bolted on, why not?
Well, and the whole point is it's a custom. You can do what you want with it. $48,000 for that 1968 Camaro. Let's go back a number of decades, back to 1932. We got a Plymouth PA Sports Roadster.
I believe this is only the second one of these we have ever seen at Barrett-Jackson, at least in the 20 years that I have been here patrolling the block with Steve. Again, straight axle front end, beautiful style. And this car looks like it has been dropped or channeled over the frame, but it is not. This is the stock profile of this, and it is a stunner, certainly easily spotted as being a distinctive two-seater separate from a Chevy or a Ford. This just has a real sleek set of lines to it.
Yes, remember, of course, that Plymouth didn't even arrive until 1929. So what we're looking at here is the third model year for Plymouth. And Plymouth was Chrysler Corporation's value leader, named after either a popular baling wire that farmers loved or the Pilgrim's Mayflower ship, the Plymouth Rock. So you choose whichever one it was. But again, Plymouth arrived in 1929, and here it is in its third model year. Very exotic and a high-quality vehicle.
The rumble seat makes this a true 2+2. And look at that windshield where you see the attachment for the top and also for where that windshield is hinged. And you can get a true flow-through fresh air experience driving this one.
Now, this one is a flathead four. You got to remember, the same year, 1932, Ford would offer you twice as many cylinders in the flathead V8. But again, here is the hole for the cranker. This does have an electric starter, but if all else failed, it still has the ability to be hand-cranked if the battery's dead.
You know, this was really a significant car for Plymouth because, you know, they were coming back trying to build things, and this was the third model year, and this car helped Plymouth become the number three seller in the United States at that point. So it's a significant car for its time. Oh, yeah, $21,000 for that 1932 Plymouth PA Sports Roadster. Let's check in with April Rose.
This is the Clydesdale, first generation 1968 Bronco. Truly one of a kind. It's the only Bronco in existence with suicide doors. Pretty sweet idea there. Now, the builder is Max Leiter Brothers Customs, and they did a fantastic job. It's got a 5.0 Coyote with Roush supercharger, a push-button 6-speed automatic with 4-wheel Wilwood super light brakes. Now, take a peek inside. It's got 3 rows of custom leather, custom gauges, and touchscreen stereo. Just really cool detailing on the leather there. I love the dark brown accents. You also got a wood steering wheel. Really nice touch. It's finished off in white with that classic stripe kit. Now, I don't know if I got enough friends to fill her up, Rick, but I'm ready to take her on the road.
Yeah, I love those suicide doors, but it's just an example of how creative and crazy they're getting in the Bronco restoration world. Any idea is fair game right now. 1984 Chevy K20 custom pickup truck.
When it's been said that the grill is the face of any vehicle, and the Chevy trucks had two different faces. This is a Silverado with four headlights. The base Chevy pickups had single oval headlights up front, but you could get the Silverado grill as an option on a Lancer truck. But again, this is a Silverado, but crazy but true, this has a Dodge Cummins turbo diesel under the hood. So the Dodge brothers are probably pumping their fists in revenge. But again, this is a nice example of a long 8-foot bed, 3/4 ton K24 wheel drive.
And this one was built to work. Dana 60 front axle, a GM 14 bolt rear, 4-wheel disc brakes, brand new Mickey Thompson 17 inch wheels, 285/70, 17 tires.
I have to say, it is bizarre to not see a Duramax V8 diesel in this, a GMC engine and a GM vehicle, but a Dodge inline Cummins, or actually it's a Cummins is what it is, but it came out of a Dodge truck. Kind of a weird thing, but hey, hot rodding, if it works, it works. And the bed is a fifth wheel trailer hook, or hitch, I should say, right there. There's the ball right there for a fifth wheel trailer.
$43,000. So $43,000. It was pretty solid money for a 1984 Chevy K20 custom pickup truck. You know, no shortage of great cards here, something to really amaze you. In fact, Craig Jackson and Tyler Hoover have their eyes on a pretty special Porsche.
We have a 2018 Porsche 911 GT2 RS. We have Tyler Hoover here from Hoovy's Garage.
It's quite a color, isn't it?
It is.
They call it Hellgren. Hell green, or a light green, sort of a jade green like the vintage Porsches. But what I love about these is just a legendary, legendary car. The most powerful Porsche 911 ever at the time. 700 horsepower, 0 to 60, something like 2.6 seconds. Power is from a twin turbocharged 3.8 liter flat six, making 700 horsepower.
I love the carbon fiber air ducts for the air to come out from under the front fenders on it. The carbon fiber on these is absolutely spectacular. This is the quintessential Porsche for me.
Wow. Holy moly. That's insane.
Zero to 60 in less than 3 seconds can really make your head spin if you're not careful. Another one of the cars that we'll see coming up this Saturday on Super Saturday is that particular Porsche. Up on the block right now, we got a 2006 Bentley Continental Flying Spur. This is the one that Tyler Hoover was showing us the engine compartment of just a little while ago.
Yeah, beautiful car with that W12, 55,000 miles on this one, barely broken in. The interior is to die for. You think the exterior in this dark blue, almost black, look inside at that light burled wood, that Sahara beige leather, all the room in that back seat. I want one.
$35,000, looks like it's sold over the phone. They'll write the price on that sold sticker and we'll take a quick break.
The all-new line of Barrett-Jackson merchandise and apparel is now available. From road rallies to the office, there are many stylish options for the car lover. Available year-round or online at shopbarrettjackson.com.
Welcome back to Barrett-Jackson Scottsdale. I'm with the Blueprint Engine Cam, taking a look at this rather infamous piece of Chevrolet small block history. Lot 94, a 1984 Chevrolet Corvette with the Crossfire fuel injection system. Chevy was trying to figure out how to be efficient and meet mandates with the government when it came to emissions, and the Crossfire fuel injection was the answer. Now, you had two throttle body fuel injectors feeding each side of the engine, so that's why it was crossing over for the Crossfire, but the performance, well, it wasn't all there. 205 horsepower, unfortunately. They made many more improvements over the years, of course, but this is a pretty interesting piece. 1 year only for the C4 Corvette, and very few still surviving, so it's really cool to see, actually.
Yeah, really neat. I love the way when that hood clamshells up, the way it looks right there. Up on the block, a 2008 Mercedes-Benz SL550 Roadster.
Well, this one's got a few extra options. It does have the AMG body kit with the front and rear valances. But look here, the three-pointed star is not just the emblem. This is solid. It's because beneath it is Mercedes' Distronic system, they called it, which would keep you from getting too close to the car in front of you. I'm not sure if they were the first to have this, but boy, they perfected it in a hurry. Now it's optional on many low-price cars. This has the Cuisinart wheels, which were stock. They have been chromed, as was often the convention during the day. Black over black with burled wood. Nice shape.
It's a 550. It has the 5.5-liter version of the Mercedes overhead cam V8 versus the 5.0. But again, 382 horsepower under that bonnet or hood, you call it. This is the epitome of long hood, short deck lid styling that just speaks of performance, and it's pretty much only easily done with a rear-wheel drive platform. Beautiful layout.
Clean Carfax, 70,000 actual miles. You see the roll bar is in the pop-up position with this air scarf attached to it. You can operate this bar manually, or it will come up on its own if needed, and we certainly hope not. A lot of life left here.
$23,000 for that Mercedes. Well, if you'd like to try and sharpen your bidding skills and maybe snag a great prize in the process, you'll want to play Fantasy Bid, brought to you by Dodge. And right now, Christian Murphy is going to preview one of the cars that you're going to have to predict the price on.
Rick, I'm with 1273, and it is one of those cars. Well, it just makes you smile. It's a 1957 Chevy Corvette Fuelie convertible. And this one, well, it is factory correct and original in everything that they've done with it. Factory polo white repaint, and on the insets there you can see the silver coves. That's all matched with those white wide wall tires, all factory correct, and factory caps on the wheels. This one is an absolute beauty. Last year it completed a complete Rochester rebuild with a 283 and period correct, of course, Fuelie heads. And as if it needed any more recognition and awards, well, it has had plenty. Again, it's just one of those cars that make you smile, and on Saturday, as it crosses the block, I am sure there are a lot of bidders going to be smiling over this one.
Thanks, Murph. You know, that Corvette, when it crosses the block this Saturday, you're going to want to make sure you go to promo.barrettjacksonfantasybid.com for the official rules, because who knows? You could walk away with the grand prize, a 2023 Dodge Challenger. Up on the block right now, a 2005 Porsche Cayenne Turbo.
Well, Porsche followed BMW and Mercedes into the SUV ranks. Their first offering was the Cayenne. And typically Porsche, there was the Cayenne. There was the Cayenne S, there was the Cayenne GTS, and there was this, the top-of-the-line Cayenne Turbo. Porsche 911 enthusiasts went, oh, what is happening to our beloved brand? And wouldn't you know it, today, the midsize Macan and the full-size Cayenne SUVs are by far Porsche's bestsellers.
That playbook has been borrowed by Ford with the Mustang Mach-E and, of course, Corvette. I guess an SUV Corvette's coming down the road.
$19,000 for that 2005 Porsche Cayenne Turbo. To those gentlemen right there, congratulations to them. All right, there is a segment in the automotive world that is just popping, and it's let's call them the SUVs, UTVs. In this case, it's a 2019 Can-Am Maverick X3 Custom ATV.
Well, it kind of looks like a swamp racer out of the bayou of down south, but this is an amazing creature. As it comes up here, these deeply grooved tractor-type tires are rattling along. This thing would be at home in sand dunes, not so much on the road. That's not what it's made for. This is crazy.
What I'm drawn to are these front hubs. Here are the half shafts, the drive shafts, which come through here. Through a gear drive system similar to what's on the military Hummers, there is the center line of the axle there. So they're able to get about a 6-inch lift on this and yet maintain all of the drive characteristics that were designed into it. This thing is large and in charge. American Force wheels on this and so many modifications.
This is crazy, a three-cylinder Rotax with a turbocharger. And the articulation, look at the rear suspension. At full compression, this thing comes down about a foot and a half to 2 feet. Look at that. I mean, this can go pretty much anywhere.
You know, we've come a long, long way from the Myers-Manx dune buggy, haven't we? I mean, ultimately it does the same thing, but the technology, the style on this thing is off the charts.
Coilovers. That's a coil spring over shock with a remote reservoir. I mean, that's just state-of-the-art stuff. And in the front, it's a rocker arm suspension, a formula car style suspension with the coilovers. Wow. This is crazy.
Inside a full roll cage, four speakers over your head, banging that Van Halen right down through your cranium into your spinal column. Wow.
Oh, there we go. That custom ATV just sold for $33,000. And they're happy to spend that money. We're going to take a break. The sun's going down here at Barrett-Jackson in Scottsdale. We'll be right back. Well, out of the McGuire staging lanes, day one of the Barrett-Jackson Collector Car Auction is starting to come to an end. We're just a few cars left that will be crossing the block. But boy, what a day it has turned out to be. Solid money on day one here at Barrett-Jackson. Off the block right now, 1970 Chevy C10 pickup.
Well, C10 is a half tonner. This one is a six lug. It has a disc brake conversion, but these would have six lug drum brakes up front until 1971 when the discs arrived. Under the hood is a 350, but again, this is the 67 through 72 body style. Very popular 8-foot bed on this one.
Boy, that is Catalina blue, and is it a bright blue metallic on this one? Those clearance lights up on the roof let you know that this is a high capacity, kind of a super duty Chevy, but not badged as a three-quarter tonner, I don't believe. Interesting piece.
It has coil springs at the back. Leafs were possible on the four-wheel drive trucks, but the coils gave you a better ride. However, not quite as much cargo capacity as the Leafs. You get either one.
You know, you think Detroit would have learned something from that, because even today, the Ram 1500 with its coil spring rear has a much better ride than the other Detroit pickups.
All right, away that goes at $17,000. Let's check out our top sellers of the day. The number three sale, that was a 1959 Chevy Impala. Custom touches, $76,000. You had to do a Cadillac to outdo that, and that's what we got. A 57 Eldorado Biarritz, $83,000. But the number one sale, it was a Cuda, a 1971 with a 340 engine, less than 40,000 original miles, hammered sold at $100,000. A very strong Monday, very strong first day here at Barrett-Jackson in Scottsdale. All right, we got a 1949 Plymouth Deluxe sedan up on the block, but this one has some interesting ownership history. Used to belong, or still belong, to Emmy Award or Academy Award winning actress Kathy Bates.
And this is in just absolutely beautiful condition for a 1949. Wasn't she the actress that tortured James Caan in Misery, the best-selling author, to keep him around? Well, she kept this car around for a long time, but it is in showroom new condition. Beautiful.
Well, that's going to do it today for our 4 hours of live coverage from Scottsdale. But we promise we're coming back tomorrow for six straight hours of auction action here on FYI. So you don't want to miss a minute. For Mike Joy, Steve Mignante, Tyler Hoover, April Rose, and Christian Murphy, I'm Richter Brule. Thanks for riding along with us today. We will be back tomorrow with a lot more.